morning, everybody. We'll call the meeting to order. Could you call the roll, please?
Vice Chair Pembroke.
Present.
Commissioner Romero.
Present.
Chairman Blankenhardt.
Present.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Present.
Welcome, everybody, to our regular meeting of November 3rd, 2015. We have the Rabbi Eli Kaminsky here, who has agreed to share a prayer with us. We'll begin with that, and we'll remain standing for the pledge. Welcome. Thank you.
Before I begin, I'd like to thank Commissioner O'Donnell for inviting me here this morning. We find ourselves in very challenging times of turmoil and confusion the world over. This is a time that we all need to reach out to each other, and specifically our youth. Education is the key in securing a better future. We must bring them the message of hope and teach them about the Creator of all beings, who cares about them and has instructed them how to live properly and serve Him, Almighty God. Please join me in prayer. Our God and God of our fathers, great, mighty, and revered God, we beseech you in your abundant mercy, keep Taos County and our wonderful country of the United States safe and secure. Strengthen and encourage its leaders to remain strong and unyielding in their efforts to educate and ensure security and peace in our land. Bless all the wonderful people gathered here to make the right decisions in enhancing our county and all of its inhabitants. Bestow upon them your blessings, and grant them the wisdom and strength to serve you in the way you desire by fulfilling the seven laws you have commanded through Moses to all of mankind, which are the fabric of every healthy society, which they are not to deny God, not to blaspheme God, not to murder, not to engage in adulterous acts, not to steal, not to torture animals, to set up courts to ensure justice and obedience to the other six laws. And bring upon us the ultimate state of world peace, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation. May we all be blessed with friendship, unity, and love. Bless us with life, prosperity, health, happiness, and redemption. Usher in the era when the whole world will serve you the way that you desire, as it is written, "For then I will turn the peoples a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of the Lord to serve Him with one consent." Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Reverend. Ms. Martinez, will you lead us in prayer?
I pledge allegiance to the
flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Commissioners, we have a motion to approve the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I wanted to add for discussion, just for information purposes only, discussion on the Doña Ana Road. Mr. Errol Salazar will present that. Basically, just discussion or presentation on the status of where we're at with that particular project in my district.
I'm sorry, Commissioner.
Doña Ana Road, that's about, what is it, Mr. Salazar, about 300 feet of road right after the town limits end.
Right.
And goes into
the spot.
Yeah, by the health spot, yeah.
Okay. Shall we make that 9B a presentation?
Sure, Mr. Chairman.
Commissioners, we have any other changes?
Motion to approve with amendment.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Vice Chair Pembroke.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhardt.
Yes. On to item 5, awards and recognition. And this is a presentation of a proclamation for DWI Week, November 16th through November 20th. Herbert Valdez, DWI Coordinator. Good morning, Herbert.
Good morning, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Commissioners. And good morning, Mr. Cordova, Councilman. I'm here to make a presentation for a proclamation for the DWI Week on November 16th through the November 20th, 2015. Taos County is joining with the Mexico DWI Coordinators Affiliate to support their efforts to reduce DWI crashes, DWI fatalities, and the use of alcohol by residents throughout the state. Manny, this is for you, also for the elected officials and the managers. We want to invite you to attend a ceremony in Las Vegas, New Mexico. I will get you the exact place when I get that information to join us. We have also invited the legislators from our region over here to be over there also, so that we can educate and show you guys what we've done as a DWI program to our region. And and share some important information with you guys also. So that is my presentation. Would you care for me to read the proclamation?
Sure. Please do.
Proclamation, DWI Awareness Week, November 16, 2015 through November 20, 2015. Whereas the county, Taos County values the health and safety of all our citizens, and whereas local leaders in government and in the community know that the support of the people in our communities is the most effective tool they can have in their efforts to reduce use of alcohol and other drugs by New Mexicans, and whereas Taos County is joining with the New Mexico DWI Coordinators Affiliate to support their efforts to reduce DWI crashes, DWI fatalities, and the use of alcohol by residents throughout the state. Whereas the New Mexico DWI Coordinators Affiliate represent 33 counties with a common goal of reducing the incidence of DWI, alcoholism, alcohol abuse, drug addiction, and drug abuse, and preventing or reducing the incidence of domestic abuse related to the use or abuse of alcohol. And whereas the DWI coordinators in these counties provide service under local DWI programs that provide compliance monitoring tracking for over 13,634 DWI offenders, ensuring that these offenders are in compliance with court order requirements. And whereas these programs throughout the state also provide more than 29,145 hours of treatment in 2014, with over 13,875 offenders receiving detoxification services. And whereas 229,745 students from kindergarten to 12th grade throughout the state also receive prevention education activities through these programs. And whereas alcohol-involved fatalities in New Mexico are down from 152 in 2009 to 133 in 2013, and serious alcohol-involved injuries are down from 998 in 2009 to 668 in 2013. And whereas alcohol-involved crashes in New Mexico have also been on a downward trend from 3,386 in 2006 to 1,955 in 2013. Whereas the reduction in alcohol-involved vehicle crash fatalities and serious alcohol-involved vehicle crashes injuries is due in part to the hard work of the local DWI programs. And whereas, according to the Youth Risk and Resiliency Survey published by the Department of Health and Public Education Department, shows that the LDWI prevention program appeared to have a positive effect on alcohol-related behaviors of New Mexico youth grade 9 through 12. The data shows that the following changes from 2009 to 2013, current drinking down from 57.7 to 28.9, binge drinking down from 35.4% to 17.1% from 2009 to 2000. Current drinking down from, drinking and driving down from 19.1% to 8.9%. Drinking before the age of 13 down from 35.8 to 22.3. The purpose of DWI awareness is to raise awareness around DWI, alcoholism, alcohol abuse, drug addiction, and or drug abuse, and the efforts of the DWI affiliates in the local DWI programs. And whereas there are activities planned during DWI Awareness Week in the counties that will focus on educating legislators and the community on efforts of the DWI affiliates and local programs. And whereas DWI Awareness Week will be celebrated in every county in New Mexico during DWI Awareness Week, November 16th to the 20th. And now there be it proclaimed that the governing body of Taos County Board of Commissioners does hereby designate November 16th to the 20th, 2015 as DWI Awareness Week. The Taos County Board of Commissioners urges all citizens, parents, governmental agencies, public and private institutions, businesses, hospitals, schools, and colleges in Taos County to support efforts that will increase community awareness, understanding, and action to address DWI in our community.
Thank you, Herbert. We really appreciate your work. The numbers are high, but the trends are good. Especially appreciate your work with the students, young people in schools. It's going to make a difference in the long run.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to appreciate all of the work, the effort that has been put into this program. Herbert, you've been handling it for how many years now?
Oh, about 11.
About 11 years, and it seems like it's doing well. Do we have numbers for Taos County specifically?
What we decided to do here was talk as a whole instead of just specific counties. We do have those numbers in the office if you'd like to see them. I can provide them for you.
Anything that you can tell us right now?
Right now, it looks like we're kind of holding steady on the DWIs that are going through our office. It's probably about, we're down about maybe 5 from last year, but still, we still have that much more to go in the year, so we don't know how many more new ones that we'll get.
And fatalities?
Fatalities are really down this year. According to the state and New Mexico State Police, this year we haven't had any DWI fatalities here in Taos County.
Thank you very much, Herbert. Move for approval, Mr. Chairman, of this proclamation.
Second.
Call for the vote.
Vice Chair Fambro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhardt.
Yes.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda is item 6, citizens' concerns. Anyone wishing to address the board at this time, may do so. Please limit your comments to 5 minutes. Mr. Silver.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Robert Silver. I thank the members of the commission for the opportunity to come before you again. I will do my best to be brief and succinct. The chairman and I joke about my tendency to use 10 words, but one would do. I'll try to keep that under control.
They said the same about me.
I have in the past spoken to you about my interest in our community hospital. It's vital as an institution for this community, and it is struggling financially and perhaps in some other ways. I suspect that before too much longer, the issue will come formally before you and request to put a tax measure on the ballot. I know that some of you have reservations about that, and I've become a strong supporter the need for public funding, but I've also suggested to the commission that you are the point of influence in terms of some reform that still would be helpful to have take place. And I'm not a CPA, I'm not an MBA, I don't have a law degree, so I claim no expertise in those areas. I do have a doctorate in psychology and a career that spanned 45 years of practice, and I treated not only sick individuals, but sick organizations. And as a matter of fact, consulted to organizations around issues of leadership and authority, and was paid rather handsomely to do that. Sometimes people tend to treat free advice as being worth what they pay for it, and that may be all to the good. But nevertheless, just in terms of telling you what claim I might have to expertise, that's where it comes from. I am a supporter of the tax measure that may come before you, but I would hope that you would form some quid pro quo, and if you do nothing else in that regard, as you know, there is no mechanism to remove a board of THS that may be performing not only badly, but counter to what the community's wishes and even your wishes would be. And not so very long ago, members of this commission were contemplating what the community gets referred to as the nuclear option, that being driven by your own frustration some time back with the unresponsiveness of the hospital board. frustrating you to the point where you had considered finding a way to cancel the hospital's lease. I hope it never gets to that point. But one thing that would be quite important would be for some measure to be built into the hospital's bylaws, providing for some means to remove a board that might not be functioning in the best interests of the hospital and the community. Currently, there is no such mechanism, and I think you know that. There are a couple of things that have appeared in documents recently that have concerned me in terms of the culture that still needs to undergo some change in the hospital. One of these was reflected in the minutes of the September hospital board meeting. If you'll permit me to just quote this briefly to you, I think you'll see what I'm talking about. Item 11 on the approved minutes from the September board meeting says the following. Bill asked the board to review the talking points, and this was with regard to talking points in favor of a tax measure. Bill asked the board to review the talking points and let him know if they are comfortable with them. He asked for any input or comments on the document. The consensus of the board was that they were in agreement with the document, with the exception of the second to last paragraph on page 1, relating to the hospital's poor position due to the hospital's past poor management. The paragraph should be changed from a negative tone to a more positive, as the hospital was in a bad position due to the changes in payment systems that created the problem and not poor management. Okay. It's often been said that those who don't recall history will tend to repeat it. My concern would be that if the board is still not acknowledging that there were problems beyond the very difficult financial situation which it found itself, that these problems would still be, would still exist. This quote from the board's minutes is essentially the organizational equivalent of the dog ate my homework. And this is just not reassuring. Now, I'm a strong fan of Bill Patten's. As far as I'm concerned, he's the real deal, but he can only be as good and as effective as his board helps him to be, and as you help him to be, and as the community helps him to be. So for our own protection going down the road, I hope that you will fashion some quid pro quo as you consider the possibility of a tax measure put to the public. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. Is there anybody else at this time who would like to address the board? Yes, please.
Hello, my name is Angie Fernandez, and I will keep my comments brief, but since they'll be brief, I'm hoping you'll join me in a moment of wellness, and that includes anyone here in the audience as well as chair and commissioners. So I'd like to invite you to join me in a breathing and posture activity. And so if we could, one thing that is really important is we forget to take a moment for our health, and we could do it anytime, anywhere, sometimes in the car, sometimes in line. You know, it's just really important. We have one body that's supposed to last us for the rest of our life. And as, you know, we're talking about increasing tax for the hospital, many of us, if we take care of our health now, we don't have to even visit that hospital. So go ahead and join me by breathing in slow and deep through your nostrils, feeling it in your abdomen as well as your chest, and then releasing your breath slowly out of your mouth. And then go ahead and continue breathing in through your nostrils and out through your mouth. And as you continue this breathing, if you'll elongate your spine and work on your posture. One thing that working on our posture will not only enhance our appearance, it'll help us look thinner, younger, and more confident. So that activity can be done at any time and should be, as breathing and working on our posture is really good for reducing our stress levels and increasing our oxygen levels. And so as we continue to breathe in handout. Let us take a moment to be thankful for something today, as gratitude is also important for our health and well-being. It's really it's good for our immune system as well, and can actually help our feeling of joy and well-being as we continue out the day by taking just a moment to think of happy thoughts, and that should be done every morning. You know, sometimes we wake up and before we really remember where we are, we could take a moment to just be joyful, and that will get us on a very healthy step for the day. But so thank you all very much for joining me in that activity. And now I just want to talk about the land use ordinance. I live in Carson Estates, Three Peaks, and as the land use ordinance is being revisited, revised, I hope that you all continue to, I don't know, allow us flexibility and our creativity as we are building a greener, a more sustainable future, and perhaps consider restricting conventional ways of building. You know, my house uses 2.5 gallons of rainwater a day. I empty my 55-gallon trash can once a year, and I use 5 gallons of propane a year. And so, as if we're not depleting necessarily the resources of the community, I hope you embrace our creativity. And perhaps as UNM has a wonderful green certification program, maybe working in partnership with them to see what is working as far as green building and design to create a more sustainable future. Thank you.
Thank you. I was feeling better with that breathing until you mentioned the LUR. But I think that all of those activities and uses in Three Peaks are okay in regards to land use regs. So I applaud you for using them. Is there anybody else at this time who would like to address the board? If not, we'll move on with the agenda to the approval of the minutes. Commissioners, we've got the minutes from the October 20th meeting. Do we have a motion for approval?
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
No further comments, call for the vote.
Vice Chair Fembrough.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes. On to 8, this is a public hearing, and this is by statute required as a public hearing to consider final passage of an amendment to our land use regs. This is Ordinance 2015-2, and we have Nathan Sanchez here, our chief planner, to present this proposed amendment, and then we will open it up for public discussion.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, first off, I'd like to say that Edward Vigil wanted to be here. He's our county director, but he came up sick this morning, so he was not able to attend. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Mr. Clerk, Mr. McGowan, today I respectfully come before the Commission to request that you look favorably upon Ordinance 2015-2, an ordinance adopting revised land use regulations for Taos County and repealing Ordinance 2014-1. In June of 2014, the Taos County Board of Commissioners approved Ordinance 2014-1, the present Taos County land use regulations, which went into effect in July of 2014. Taos County planning staff has been implementing Ordinance 2014-1 for a little over a year. During this period, planning staff identified areas of the land use regulations that were too stringent, others that required clarification, revision, or outright deletion. The process to revise the land use regulations began earlier this year, where planning staff, along with the legal department, worked diligently to get to this point. We had several work studies with you, the commission, where planning staff presented the proposed substantive changes, revisions, and where we received feedback from all of you. We heeded your input, your recommendations and suggestions, and the ordinance before you today incorporates them as best as possible. I am pleased to say that I believe that Ordinance 2015-2 revised land use regulations are more people-friendly and will be a significant tool in the development of Taos County into the future. In addition, approval of Ordinance 2015-2 provides a clear path for neighborhoods to commence and complete their respective overlays, which will ultimately come before you as amendments to the ordinance. As we learned it with Ordinance 2014-1, that land use regulations are an evolving document. As times and conditions change, so will the land use regulations. Taos County initially adopted land use regulations as a temporary document in 1995. Since then, land use regulations were revised in 1997, 2003, 2005, and 2014. I want to take a minute to recognize the planning staff, Mr. Bob Malone, County Attorney, Mrs. Shannon Brumley, County Paralegal, for all the hard work that has been put into this document. In closing, I thank you for the opportunity to come before you today and for the consideration given to Ordinance 2015-2. I respectfully request that the Commission approve Ordinance 2015-2, an ordinance adopting revised land use regulations for Taos County and repealing Ordinance 2014-1. I stand for.
Thank you, Nathan. Commissioners, any questions on these proposed amendments? We've gone over them a few times, but are there any?
I'd rather hear the public first.
Okay. Thanks, Nathan. In that case, we will open up the public hearing, and anybody who wishes to address this issue, please do so at this time. Just state your name on the podium. Let us know what you're thinking. No? David.
Raise your hand. Do you swear and affirm under oath on penalty of lawful perjury that the testimony you're about to give is true and false?
Yes. Good morning, commissioners and public. I'm David Maes, and I'm president of the Ranchos Neighborhood Association. I've been president now for, I forget how many years, I think it's about six. I met Mr. Cordova this morning, the new county manager, and I told him that he's the fifth county manager that I've worked under since we started working on these never-ending LURs, neighborhood plans. But I digress. I wanted to make two general points regarding the LUR and neighborhood plans. Yesterday, I went up to the planning office because I wanted to ask either Nathan or Edward what the discussion was going to be about today. And neither one of them were there, and I happened to run into Jim Fambro, and I asked him. And I pointed out to him that many of the neighborhood association people have died waiting for this thing to come to fruition. And he turned to me and he said, I don't think the LUR has really killed anybody yet. And then we were interrupted, and I think he went away with the impression that that's what I was getting at. My only point was it's been a long time that we've been working on this. And there have been many reasons, and it's been a long road. But I did want to impress upon you that just delaying these things has consequences. And you are not going to find the same interest and participation in neighborhood associations that you did at the very beginning. I've talked to almost all the neighborhood associations. And, you know, a lot of the folks are older, and some have died, and some have become very ill. I've had a couple of members that have almost died, because we're older, retired folks that work on this thing. And so, anyway, we need to move on this thing and try to get the neighborhood plans passed as soon as we can. And so that's one point I wanted to make. And the other is that I was just going over the latest changes to 2015-2. Eugenia was showing me the red line changes, and they're substantial. And I would suggest to the commission that we have as many working group training sessions for the neighborhoods as needed so that we can come up to speed on the changes that you're proposing. I don't think a lot of the neighborhood association members even understood the 2014 ones, as I don't think a lot of the new commissioners really understand a lot of the details that go into these plans. They're very complicated. And we have a really tough task going to our communities, engendering interest in coming to a meeting where you talk about setbacks and you talk about ordinances and you talk in a language that's completely foreign to many of them, trying to get them interested, trying to get them to understand. You've got to do this in about an hour because people start leaving. And so it's very difficult, and you can help us out by offering us some training so we can understand the changes that go forward. And I would again propose to the commission, as I have in the past before some of the members were here, that they look at contracting with a planner, like you did in the past with Charlie Deans, to go out and help the neighborhood associations. I tell you, when we start working on this new matrix, there's a lot of questions that come up, and I'm not an expert in this, but you end up the person that's chairing the meeting. And you know, we have maybe a dozen neighborhood associations. We end up raising more questions than we're able to answer. And so if we could have somebody in the future like Charlie Deans did in the past, for you, I mean, some of you know what that was all about, that would really help us to move forward. It would really help not only the neighborhood associations, but all the communities to get the plan completed. And so, thank you. If you have any questions on me?
Mr. Chairman, thank you, Mr. Maez, for being here today. I was proud of the fact that you're from my district, from the Ranches area, and you've been a leading force behind it all, trying to get the communities and the neighborhoods involved in the whole process. Some of the red line items, are there any that immediately stick out as major concerns that you can mention to the commission at this time?
No, not specific things. I was just talking to Eugenia about. I think she's gone over the red line changes in great detail with her group. But I think that would probably be best for a work study group. And I'd like as many of the commissioners to come to that as possible. And I would say that let's have work study group for the neighborhood associations. I don't know if you can do that, but if you open it up to the general public, what happens is you get all these people from all over the place and they treat it like a public hearing and you argue points about ordinances that have been passed and points that we've gone over, you know, ad nauseum for 6 years. I'd like to get some work done and be more of an instructional session than a public hearing session.
So your recommendation is approval today, but
yes,
later on having these courses?
Yes. And I mean, we could have gone forward even with the 2014, just so we could start working on the plans, because as has been said many times, this is a living document. We can change things as we go along. Nothing's set in stone. And I would just like to really get started as soon as we can.
And Mr. Chairman, question for Mr. Sanchez and our county managers, to what is the status on the possibility of hiring that facilitator?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romero, the plan is from planning staff is that I will, because I am the long-range planner, I will be promoting most of my time to this process. The online plan, and as staff, we're just trying to streamline the process as much as possible. We're going to work with the neighborhoods. There's some things that still need to be addressed as with legal, but a lot of them have been working on legal in their area. They want to do certain changes, but we're actively working with the neighborhoods. as the process goes forward, I will be spending more time with them.
Leandro.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romero, and on that point, we are working with the planning director to probably hire additional staff to take some of the workload off Nathan to allow him to be able to focus on those as his primary duty for a while until we can take care.
Is there an additional staff person? Is that in any way related to a possible agreement with the town?
We are waiting to see what happens with that and decide which direction exactly. We have a lot of needs in planning, GIS, mapping, so we just want to make sure we get the right pick for the person that we bring in. Mm-hmm.
At this point, you know, we have a matrix overlay that has been developed. Nathan has to do one or two very minor tweaks to it as a result of land use regs, assuming they get passed today. But that's, you know, just the setbacks and the sequia, maybe one or two definitions. But we now have a standardized list of all the uses, and the work is going to come in trying to figure out where those uses are going to be most appropriate within a particular neighborhood. And that's really the crux of it. You know, all of these circumstances always result in a handful of people doing most of the work. It's just the nature of democracy, I guess. And I agree with you wholeheartedly, David, everything you said. You know, we need to get that matrix out to all the neighborhood association leaderships so that they can work with it. Now, Regina, in Upper Colonias, they've already done a ton of work, and they're very close to actually having a plan that they can bring forth. There's going to be some questions about the process. Once a neighborhood association has a plan that they're comfortable with and that they have some consensus within their neighborhood, obviously it's not going to be unanimous, but as long as they can bring in a plan and show us that there's consensus, then we have to decide how we're going to pass it. I favor, at that point, the planning department presenting it as an amendment to the LUR rather than requiring the neighborhood association to present it. Both of those possibilities are allowed within the LUR. I favor the planning department doing it because it lessens the burden on the neighborhood association in terms of publications and various other processes. So I hope we end up moving in that direction shortly. I do think that Upper Colonias is probably going to be the first one since they are furthest along. And it's going to be really important to implement these overlays because that is one of the purposes of all of the work that we've done in the past few years. That's my speech. I don't know if there's any other. I know we are. I get to say stuff in the public part. Eugenia.
I would. They could put me in jail for a lot of other things.
They want to do this. They want to do the best. They want to first.
I do. I'm Eugenia Hauber, H-A-U-B-E-R. I'm president of the Upper Los Colonias Neighborhood Association. I think it seems like I've been president forever and ever and ever. But I've sworn to...
You're still alive.
Oh, barely.
See my point, Nick?
Yeah, we're both barely.
I wanted to first of all thank Nathan. We had an advantage over everyone except perhaps Stagecoach because we already had our overlay that had been approved. So we had something to go on. And what we did was to say, this was approved, our neighborhood approved it, people seem to like it. So our main job is to take what we already have and then to adapt it to the matrix form. One of the real problems we ran into was when we got the matrix of all of the uses, commercial uses, and there were not a lot of definitions in the LUR for many of these. And we were a group of six, sometimes seven, someone winners in Las Vegas. And we said, you know, how can we approve a use for something that isn't defined. So we went to Tom, and Tom went to Nathan, and there are so many new definitions in the LUR, thanks to Nathan and the wonderful work that planning has done. We're happy with the amendments. Let me ask one thing. I realized that I had sort of forgotten to look for something. Early on, the area of notification was going to be increased for special use permits. And did that make it into the final?
To the 1,000 feet from the 250.
Oh, very good. Okay. That was something that we were very much in favor of. So I think that representing Upper Las Colonias, we're pleased with the new LUR, and we would certainly urge quick passage. We are almost ready to take it to planning. And I will also say that on the question of who has to pay for the notification, we're not the biggest neighborhood association. We have a lot of sort of wealthy people, and you know, we're not poor, but we don't have any dues. We have about $800 in our bank account, and that amount has been stable for over a year since our last sort of mass postcard mailing to our members. And we're gonna have to do more, because when we finally go through planning and we get the final draft, then we'll send it out by email. But for about 25% of our members, we don't have email addresses. So for those people then, we have to send out notification saying, this is to be found on our website. If you don't have access, you can pick up a hard copy, and which we'll provide to you. And please give us comments and things like that. And we feel that's a really important thing, but once again, that's about $300 just to do that by postcard. So we would urge that the county help us out whatever to the greatest extent possible. And we're looking forward to, as Lou Sturboy, our esteemed leader on the overlay, says, you know, the train is about to leave the station, so we're all, yeah, let's get aboard and get out of here. So thank you all.
Thank you, Gina. Really appreciate the work you guys have done. It helped drive the amendments today, you know, as you said, identifying those different uses and coming up with definitions. That's a big part of the amendments we've done, and your group and others have been a big part of that. You know, the way I see it is neighborhoods are helping us determine what uses are appropriate for their area. And then it's up to us to review it. Obviously, we're going to get the final say. Planning isn't going to necessarily agree with everything you come up with, and neither will this board. But I suspect that the vast majority of it will be agreed with. And at that point, it's just our responsibility. You know, the LUR is our ordinance, and it's going to be our responsibility to amend it with the help of these organizations that are really showing us how the zoning should play out in our county. David?
Just one suggestion. From what I understand, the matrix and the changes are, you know, 98% done and they're ready to go. I still don't know if I can get an answer on, can they be released and can we start working on them? And that's something else. But what I was going to suggest was, why don't we start on the training sessions? We could, like we had one in here after they passed the LUR in June of 2014. We had a training session on September 15th, and that's the last thing. And we had this room was almost full of neighborhood association people. And I think it's going to take more than one or maybe even two training sessions to go through, number one, the changes to the LUR, and then specifically on using the tool, the matrix. There's going to be a lot of questions on that. And I think we could start doing that. And one thing, since I've been through this cycle so many years, is you run into these seasonal problems. Now, after Thanksgiving, you're not going to be able to get anybody in here in any numbers until after New Year's. So we maybe have a chance between now and Thanksgiving to have one meeting. I don't know if we're ready to do that yet, but after that, you're pretty much gone. We've tried to have meetings between Thanksgiving and Christmas and New Year's. And, you know, the neighborhood, everybody's out traveling or out, you know, on visiting family and stuff. So really, maybe after New Year's, sometime in January would be the best time to start. But I would suggest that we just start having those training meetings in the neighborhoods, get a footing and get going. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who would like to comment, address the board in this public hearing on the proposed amendment? If not, I'll close the public hearing at this time. Commissioner Pembroke.
Thank you, Chairman. Something that Jeremiah said is what I want everybody to remember. This is a living document. This is something that can change. This is something that adapts, and if it doesn't work for your area, you don't have to do it. And the way you put it was a lot more eloquent than what I did, but it's still, as of 10 o'clock today, it still hasn't killed anybody. So we're still hanging in there pretty good. I want to thank our planning staff for the way they brought these changes and amendments to us systematically over the period and allowed comment during each process. And we did have some good comments, and we did catch that one on the 1,000-foot, and I think that was very important to a lot of people to have that in there, and I'm glad that we did. Ms. Fernandez brought up some great initiatives, and I last week was in Alberta conference and they talked about a water reuse plan. You know, eventually, Nathan, I'd like to see that brought into this. There's so many cool ideas that other countries and other places are doing, using your gray water to you know, where we waste the most water is flushing our toilet. Why aren't we using a different type of water than clean water to do that? And we had great ideas on that. Balancing the green water, the blue water, and the gray water together for a smart water plan is something that will probably be a part of this in years to come. It's not anything that's a real quick thing, but when we got people like Ms. Fernandez that is pledging to give really good ideas and stuff like that, those are the people we need to drive that and bring that into it.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Campbell, to address that, we just finished the fifth year where Michael Reynolds has been doing a test site facility, actually studying all those different types of building skills over the last 5 years. He presented to the planning commission, he had 5 years to complete the process. He's gonna ask for an extension, but maybe here in the future, I would like to bring him forward to present to the board of commissioners his findings and update you on where he's at in that process. And from that, what he learned from there, he's basically presenting it to the different state agencies to see if they're willing to change their regulations to encumber what he's learned.
Thank you for that, Nathan. And with that, Mr. Chairman, as soon as we're ready, I'm ready to make a motion.
Okay, great. These changes have been published for a month now.
Yeah, they've been published according to statute, which was one publication 2 weeks prior to this meeting.
Okay, 2 weeks. All right.
They also, of course, put the subject of work studies on multiple occasions prior to this.
Right, as noted by Commissioner Fambro, we do appreciate the way Planning Department has handled this and walked us through all of the changes in the course of those work studies.
Let me correct that, Chairman. There were two publications of this statute.
Thank you, Bob. Well, commissioners.
Motion to approve Ordinance 2015, Land Use Reg.
We have a motion on the table.
I'll go ahead and second, Mr. Chairman.
We have a motion, we have a second. Are there any other questions or discussions from the board? If not, we'll call for the vote.
Vice Chair Fembro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes.
Good job, David. Nathan, can you answer David's question real quick about when those matrices can be distributed and when we could have a work meeting here in the evening like we did?
I could probably set up something for next week. I'll start working on it today. Right, and come up and I'll keep you contacted, David. We have a good email contact list with all the neighborhoods, and we'll send a notice out today. Next week, we'll try to set up for maybe Thursday evening or so. But I have to look at the schedule for the commission chambers and without other research.
That would be very helpful. Look forward to it.
Okay.
Thank you. On to presentations at this time. 9A, this is a presentation from Taos Health Systems. We have Bill Patten, the CEO of Holy Cross, and Anna Abeyta, the Patient Care Services Vice President with us. Thank you both for coming. We also have Steve Rosenblum, who is the Chief Financial Officer of Taos Health Systems. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning, Commissioners. We appreciate the opportunity to come back and present our second monthly report card for you. And before we jump into that, if you don't mind, I'd like to update you on an issue that just became public yesterday afternoon. I have a copy, if I may.
Excuse me.
We issued a press release yesterday afternoon talking about negotiations that are underway basically to move CVI from employees of QHR to become employees of Taos Health Systems. The conversation began. QHR has had legal issues in the state related to managed hospitals where the CEO and CFO are employed, and they wanted to talk with the Taos Health Systems board about the possibility of limiting their risk. And in order to accomplish that, they would move us from their payroll to the local payroll. From a local perspective, we see this as a very good thing. Steve and I have often said that it doesn't matter who we get our check from, we work for Taos Health Systems. This would put that issue aside. So since we had the opportunity to talk with you today, I wanted to make sure that you were aware of these circumstances. So this will happen, and then the board will go into conversations as far as whether they want to renegotiate and or renew the current agreement with QHR. You should have copies of our most recent report card for the public as well. The one item that I wanted to speak to from the report card, and of course answer any questions, was the employee satisfaction item. It continues to be blank, and that is because we haven't done an employee satisfaction survey in a number of years. A year ago, June, we did a survey. It was very limited in scope, only focused on communication. So when I have what I call all staff meetings, every quarter I meet with as many employees as are free. I ask them, when do they want to have another employee satisfaction survey? When the one was done a year ago, June, a commitment was made to repeat it this June. And so I said, we can repeat it now if you want. You can give me 3 months to see what I can do, or you can give me 6 months. And a vast majority of employees voted to give me 6 months. So in December, we'll be performing a satisfaction survey. At our leadership meeting just yesterday, we went through the company that we're going to use and the questions that we're going to ask. We're going to make those available to the employees prior to the survey, so there's no question what the questions are decided, supposed to decide. But I just wanted you to know that after December, so sometime in January, February, we'll be able to fill that one in. That's why it continues to be blank. I thought Anna could give you an update regarding some of the transfers, and then if Steve could speak to some of the numbers, and then we'd be happy to answer any questions.
Great, thank you.
Okay, good morning.
Good morning.
So on the transfers, I think everybody got a copy of the transfers. So the trend is not changed. The majority of our transfers are due to cardiac, and that continues to be the top one as far, and then next to that would be trauma and orthopedics, and then psychiatric. So those are our top transfers that we do from the hospital. We have, I think, as far as what you have in front of you is also the reason is the numbers. So the numbers are, as I've stated, they're for June, July, August, and September. If you notice, in September there might be a fewer, but it's pretty much average the number of transfers that we have. We have the mode of transportation, and that is ground helicopter, fixed wing, and private vehicle. As you can see, our ground ambulance is our highest mode of transportation. Mr. Fambro asked me to look for the number of transfers, ground transfers that Taos County did and the ones that Red River did. I did that, but I do want to just say one thing before I present that. There is more transfers from Red River than Taos County, and Taos County has given us for each of those transfers that they were unable to transfer for whatever reason. They supported what that reason was. So the total transfers beginning in June for Taos County was 86, and for the Red River was 101. 10 of the transfers that Taos County was unable to do were due to they did not have paramedics available for the transfers, and they were high acuity patients. So that puts you pretty close to the two being back and forth. But that's the primary reason as to why they're unable to transfer is the lack of paramedic. Okay. And I think that's it. Is there any other questions?
The numbers for this year look way higher. Can we go back to that?
Sure. They are higher. And there are a few things that we are doing, and I don't know if I'm going to get into the bed situation. So there are some things, there are some transfers that we do that we could possibly keep at our hospital if we were able to take out some higher acuity patients, not necessarily critical care patients, but higher acuity. So one thing that we are looking and moving on right now is to have a unit of what we're going to call right now, that naming change, to universal bed. In other words, we can change the acuity of that bed. It can be critical care or it can be an observation, but we can just move it back and forth. We need to train our staff to be able to take care of all the different acuities that would be in that unit, as well as pediatrics. So some of the transfers that we've done have been because of the high acuity and not having more than the two ICU beds. So we think that's going to help us a lot. That's just sort of a stepping stone to what our goal is. And our goal is that we would like to someday really have all our beds be that type of bed, that we could actually make it any acuity that we need and that our staff would be able to take care of patients at any acuity. But this would be the beginning, the first step. It would be 6 beds that we're talking about right now, training that staff, making sure the equipment is what we need in that area, and getting the proper licenses for information technology and those kind of things. So we're actively doing that. We hope to get that completed and ready to go by the first of the year. And so we are moving really quickly on that. So when you say you've seen an increase in the transfer, some of those transfers could have stayed here. Not necessarily ICU patients, but a higher acuity type patients that we should be able to take care of here. And now, and another thing that's going on is, as you guys know, Dr. Ismail and Dr. Constantine are both cardiologists that are remaining in Taos. However, they're only doing an outpatient practice. I know they've made a proposal to us about having an, they're doing inpatient and ER. They've made a proposal of having a possible outpatient cardiac service also. However, they're not interested in being that person. So we're talking about that, but
if you look at our cardiac numbers, those are the highest numbers that we have right now. However, a lot of cardiac patients that we do get, we wouldn't be able to keep anyway because the standard of care is a lot of times just to go into, you know, having angiograms and that kind of thing that we cannot perform here. But I believe our numbers will have a lot less transfers come the first of the year than we are right now. So I don't know, that's about the two things that I can tell you that we're doing right now to see if we can keep that going. The other thing that we know that there's a lot of displeasure in the community with our patients is the wait times in the emergency room. Sort of, there's another a part of our strategic plan that we're working on is to have a fast-track urgent care. We are going to choose to call it expedited care as to where we can take care of our lower acuity patients pretty quickly, send them on their way, and that way we have, the rest of our staff would be taking care of our higher acuity patients. We believe that that's going to make a big difference in our emergency room. We are in the process of getting that going also because we have to really do a pro forma on that, really looking at the cost and what it's going to do as far as staffing and those kind of things. So that's happening right now.
Is the fiscal year 3 months now? Is that July, August, September? Are those numbers July, just 3 months?
We have
the 37 ICU.
June, July, and August, mm-hmm. and then we have August, September, and October. So we are we start our fiscal year in June.
Right. So we've averaged 60 a month ER, which extrapolates out to 720 a year, which is really high. It's really a whole lot higher than the 400, 463, and then 595. So that's concerning. And I know that you have outlined two steps that you believe will help with that, encouraged by that plan. How much of that, we went from 40, 35, 40 a month to 60 a month in a fairly short period of time. Is the bulk of that cardiology?
A lot of it is cardiology, but you have to remember another thing is that we stopped pediatric care also. So we started transferring a lot more pediatrics than we were in the past. And right now we do have two full-time pediatric hospitals that are working for us. So we are keeping pediatric patients now. And so we were transferring more pediatrics. The other thing we are really looking at is the orthopedic or the trauma-type patients. How much of those trauma patients, whether they be orthopedic or otherwise, could we possibly be keeping here? One of the things that broke out from that was the high acuity post-operatively of taking care of some of these patients and not having the bed and personnel to take care of them. So what we're doing with the universal bed is going to take care of that part as far as the orthopedic trauma and some of the general surgery that's going out.
With more pediatric care and more cardiology care and a better use of beds, do you expect to be able to get back to closer to 40 than 60?
Well, we certainly hope so.
Is that beyond your expectations?
I don't know that we want to say that we can get down to 40 right away. May in the future, but I think if we could shoot for 10, 15, less transfers, that would be great. Come on.
Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Steve Rosenblum, CFO of Taos Health Systems. I think one other thing to keep in mind with regard to the transfers is that summer is generally a little more busy than we see volume-wise, at least in the late summer and early fall. So September, October, November generally are a little bit slower months than June, July, and August. So I think there might be cycle that's impacting those numbers as well for the first 4 months of our fiscal year. From a financial standpoint, we did record a positive operating income for the fourth consecutive month in September. It's been several years since we've had four consecutive months of positive income. They're not big numbers. You can see on the dashboard that it's only about 1.9% year to date. That's not really enough of an operating income to sustain a business in the long term, especially when you consider the capital equipment infrastructure needs that we have. 1.9% just won't cover that over the long term. So it's a positive trend. It's very encouraging. We're way better than we were a year ago, where we sustained a loss through the first 4 months. So we see things going in the right direction, but it's a very slow climb to get to the point where we can sustain that to pay for our capital needs. The other thing that you'll notice is our days cash on hand has improved. In part, that's because I've been holding cash, and you can see that as our days in accounts payable are still at 70. I've been holding the cash because of the ICD-10 implementation, which was effective October 1st. We were concerned that there might be delays in payments from our payers, the federal government, state government, and commercial payers all, with this implementation of a totally new system across the country. So far, we haven't seen any particular delays. Medicare's released information that show that they are paying consistent with what they were doing under the ICD-9 program. So if we get through November and we're not seeing any delays, we hope to bring down that accounts payable, days in accounts payable. That will also reduce our days of cash on hand. So we're trying to manage that situation as best we can. Any questions on the financial components of this report? Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
So, Commissioners, if I could add just a couple more comments regarding the ER transfer. There are so many different issues that affect that one number. And what we're trying to do is to make sure from a systems perspective, a space perspective, and a personnel perspective, that our medical staff feels comfortable keeping as many patients as appropriate here locally. Ultimately, it is the medical staff that makes the decision on whether care should be provided locally or transferred. There are a change as far as the mix of the doctors that we have today versus the numbers from a few years ago, and we are working to make sure that they are comfortable. So the universal care, what we're trying to do is get past this issue of we only have two ICU beds. We really don't provide ICU level if you compare us to UNM or Presbyterian. Honest characterization is appropriate. We provide a higher acuity or a critical level of care, but not the ICU like the Presby and UNM. So we're trying to get past that. But it is a space issue, it is a staff training issue. And so we're bringing all of those resources to bear in active conversation with our nursing staff as well as our hospitalists, so that everyone who has sort of a piece of this pie is comfortable moving forward. Ultimately, in a setting like ours, all of our rooms need to be acuity adaptable, because some days we're going to have all low acuity patients, other days we're going to have high acuity. And so we can't afford to say we have a limited number of ICU beds. We need to be able to flex, and that's what our goal is. And so the current conversation is to start with 6 beds, but ultimately, as we look at the long-term plan, to make almost all of our beds acuity adaptable. The other comment that I wanted to add, I mentioned two important points. We had lapses in coverage of both pediatrics and cardiology. We addressed those partially. So we've hired a pediatrician, so we now have a full-time pediatrician, a full-time nurse practitioner who are covering the inpatient side. They will be starting a limited outpatient practice in a few months. And cardiology, we haven't covered on the inpatient side and the ED side, but the conversation we had at the board meeting last week was, should Taos Health Systems look at recruiting and employing a full-time outpatient cardiologist? So the board directed me to put together a pro forma to look at what that model would look like. The thinking is that unless someone has a stable income, something the hospital could provide, we're not going to be successful in that recruitment. And filling that void on the outpatient side, we think, is an important piece. My last two comments, as we build the strategic plan, there are two big initiatives that we're working on that I think will position us for the long term. Number one is a facility master plan. We received notification from the USDA that our loan to build the medical office building has been extended by one more year. But I think we need to have a conversation that we put the MOB within the context of the overall space needs of the entire campus. So I'm going to be budgeting for a facility master plan. And then also, we need to be looking long range at what our medical staff needs are. We typically have looked fairly short term. I think that we need to look long term and look at what are the retirement plans so that we can have succession plans, what are the areas where we don't have enough coverage, what are the areas where we don't have coverage at all, and build a long-term plan that will sustain a medical staff, because you can't be a hospital without a vibrant medical staff. Any other questions we could answer for you today?
Commissioner Pembroke.
Just to reiterate, what brought up the transfer conversation was the complaint of the citizens saying that the services that they need aren't being offered, that they were eliminated in a sense to expose the need for more funding and stuff.
Oh, I can't speak to what happened before, but I can tell you today, our goal is to keep as many within the EOP.
And that's what I'm hearing here.
Yeah. So one thing that we didn't touch on, we've identified the possibility of creating an observation unit that is part of the ER. Right now, we admit patients to the med-surg unit to observe them. We've actually identified space that we think can work, so we're going to be in conversations with the state to see if we could actually renovate that space and create a 3 to 5 bed observation unit that's hung right off of the ER. So the expedited care model is another example of where we're trying to address our throughput, our overall capacity within the ED. But I would tell you, ER is the face of the hospital in many respects. We need to have as high a percentage of admissions out of that ER as we possibly can, not low.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, I have a few questions for you, Mr. Patten. It seems like the locums are eating you alive, so that's going to be, I think, a key to the piece of getting doctors on board. Is Dr. Good still with you?
Yes.
Okay. Could you give us a brief report on the cost of the disaster at the hospital? Did insurance pay? Never heard back on what was your figure on $15,000 loss, or I just wanted to know what happens.
And I'll make preliminary, but Steve will be a better one to answer the question. As it relates to Dr. Good, presentation was made at the last board meeting related to her practice. She came and made a presentation, an overview to of her practice to the board. We actually are pursuing getting her additional space. So we're looking at moving her off the campus. This is something she's entirely in support of. So we've identified space. We've done an initial floor plan. We have an estimate on what building that space will be. We're now moving into negotiating the lease and getting construction documents. Dermatology is an important piece of the overall success as we have outlined it for the future. You mentioned locums. Locums, if I remember right, Steve, we've spent somewhere between $400,000 and $500,000 thus far this fiscal year on locums, which is a big number, but much lower than it had been in the past. So while our recruitment efforts still need to bear more fruit, we have made a significant dent in what we used to be spending on locums. So with those sort of overview comments, I'd ask Steve to come and answer your question regarding the hazard situation.
So first, Bill's correct. I believe our year-to-date spending on locums is about $440,000, which is probably half of what it was last year through the first 4 months. So Bill's made some changes and some hires that have really improved that situation. With regard to the ED event, we have filed a claim with our insurance company. I don't have the exact number. I believe it's between $25,000 and $30,000. They're still evaluating that claim. Most of it is associated with equipment that was damaged when the windstorm and the rain came through. We do have some other hazmat cleaning. I think that was about $13,000 bill associated with the hazmat team.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, if I could ask you, could you tell us what's going on with quorum and why? I mean, I had kind of been expecting this press release. I had heard this was in works. But what's going on with quorum?
So, as I mentioned, quorum had a legal action with one of their New Mexico hospitals, and they believe that that action increases their risk for the management employed model.
Is that the Alamogordo case?
I believe so.
Okay.
And so based on that, they wanted to have a conversation with the local board to see about reducing their risk, but at the same time addressing concerns that had been expressed at the local level. At the study group, for example, there were conversations about, can you get consulting advice from the same company from which you're getting your CEO and CFO? I think that this gives us an opportunity to address that in a very positive way.
How many other employees are at Holy Cross that are paid by Quorum?
Steve and I are the only two.
You're the only one? Okay. Well, all I can say is if you can completely extract yourself from Quorum, both in your contracts, the two separate contracts you have with Steve and yourself, and the services or the provider, I'd be more inclined to consider voting favorably to move that tax forward. But I mean, you do that, you get rid of quorum, then maybe we can talk. That's just my opinion. Thank you.
So, the quorum question, the situation with quorum is there's a consulting contract for a few hundred thousand, and then there's the employment contract for a few hundred thousand, and it sounds like...
And their services, don't they have a contract for basic supplies and...
So as part of our services side of the contract with QHR, we have access to their general purchasing organization. And so all of the discounts that we get on the supplies that we buy come under that contract. So there are a number of other GPOs out there. The one we have with Quorum, in my experience, is a very good GPO.
When does that particular contract expire?
So that's part of the contract that is up for renewal and expires April of next year, April 2016.
Be nice to see what else is out there and if the other companies can match. Thank you.
The thing I like about separating the contracts is, I think what you alluded to, which is that if you're not an employee of Quorum, then as the CEO, you can more fairly and openly judge whether or not the service side of the Quorum contract is the best that THS can do. And that's what always bothered me when they were both under the same contract. So applaud THS's efforts to move in that direction. Just to follow up.
I think everything's moving in a good direction.
I do too.
Discussion? Yes, and I just may I like to thank Mr. Patten for having myself and Mr. Jaramillo. We met with him about a month ago, kind of early on into my new tenure, and it was a very productive conversation, and I appreciate that, and I look forward to more, and I do agree that you guys are in the right path, so thank you for your hard work.
I think it's fair to say that one of the big issues with keeping a vibrant and successful TELUS health systems in our community is recruitment, you know, in order to provide the services that we all want. They are going to have to move on that path that they've set forth. But it's a lot easier to recruit if you have a healthy balance sheet and a stable financial outlook. And I think that that remains lacking. 30 days cash reserves just are not enough for any organization to run, especially if the capital improvement side of the equation has been under met, hasn't had sufficient resources. So the combination of low cash reserves and falling behind on capital expenditures is dangerous. And TELUS County cannot afford to lose our hospital or our health systems.
Mr. Chairman, I'd still like to get clarification on the New Mexico Hospital Loan Equipment Fund, and I'm wondering if there was a way where the county could enter into some kind of agreement with the Equipment Loan Council. Maybe that would be anti-donation, but if some of your bigger needs are equipment purchases, I don't know how that bond is set up, if it raises property taxes or you just take out a loan. I'm not sure, but maybe we could co-sign on a loan. I don't know the details. It's high finance, but maybe at some point I would still like that to be visited, Mr. Patten, and get some clarification, please.
It is still on our list.
All right, thank you. Yes.
Commissioners, we are going to have to bring a question to this board. And my inclination is to try to get it on a upcoming agenda this fiscal year, or this calendar year. And I wondered if there were any other thoughts on that from the rest of the commissioners.
Mr. Chairman, I want to see what happens April 2016.
I'm sorry?
I want to see what happens April 2016 related to quorum.
Any other thoughts? Well, then let me ask you, Bill. The question would be brought to the electorate, brought to the citizens of Taos County, whether or not to raise the mill levy 1 mil for a period of 4 years, which would produce about 1.4 million per year for each of those 4 years. And then at the end of 4 years, it would go back again for another election. And at that point, the people, if it passed, if it all passed to begin with, the people of Taos County could decide whether or not it was worth re-upping. What do you consider to be the time frame that is critical for Taos Health Systems?
So we have projected our capital needs for the next 3 years, and we're well in excess of $10 million for the next 3 years. The word I would use is capital equipment and building maintenance has been neglected. So we're behind. So for us to get caught up, as well as stay current, is going to be a big number. And the longer we wait to get the clock ticking, because if you look at when the vote happens, and then how long before the money actually begins to flow, if we are talking April or May, and there are considerations around when other elections happen, if a special election, then we're talking well into 2017 before we would see money. And I have serious concerns about our ability to wait that long. So right now we are balancing limited purchases from cash reserves as well as taking on a limited amount of debt. But the debt just, it's kicking the can down the road, so to speak. It hurts our monthly operations and we can't take on enough debt to fix the problem. So I understand the concern about QHR and that you would like to see results. So between now and April, you're talking 6 months. And then for the process to begin in April, you're talking even more time. I would just be very concerned about waiting that long. We're going to do what we can in the interim. Certainly, I think we've shown, and a lot of the success that we're showing over the last 3 months is from work that my team did before I got here. Cindy Bradley, I think, deserves a lot of the credit for the results that we're seeing now. We are committed to turning the organization around, but on our own, we can't address the backlog as well as the current needs. So we do need help, and I guess my plea would be the sooner the better.
Commissioner Romero. Mr. Chairman, I would really like to see a timeline on paper that would be developed between Mr. Patten, our manager, and our staff, so that we know what all these deadlines are going to be, how much you intend to raise or how much you need to raise within the next 3 years. You mentioned a figure of $10 million. And so it would also include a list of where those $10 million would go. What are the necessities at this time?
And we're happy to do that. We produced that list for the study group, so it already exists. But I would be more than happy to work with Mr. Cook if you're over there and provide you with information that would be useful to you.
And Mr. Chairman, perhaps if our county manager could check on the New Mexico Equipment Loan Council to see, can we pledge the building against a loan? Can we pledge equipment? Can we just find out where that stands and how we can help, if at all, or if they have to pledge, they have to pledge the equipment since they don't own the building?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner O'Donnell, I think first point of clarification is we're not able as a governmental entity to pledge as collateral. We need to be able to pledge a revenue source. And so we would have to give up or dedicate a source of revenue that we probably are in need of at this time. So that is my concern on that. Also, total amounts of debt that entities allowed to carry, we're close to that. And it's a combination of educational bonds that are outstanding and this big loan that we have in the building, but it wouldn't be as easy for us to extend our debt capacity as we would like it to be. We need to work on our own debt and knock out a lot of what we have outstanding prior to being able to really help other entities. In my opinion, at this time, we certainly do have to dedicate or pledge revenue to any debt.
I mean, I think it's clear that the only way that we can help health systems is to ask the public to make a decision about a mill levy. And if a mill levy was successful, then that could certainly be used as a stream of revenue to go to the loan fund and get a very beneficial terms on a loan. I mean, you know, if a mill levy was passed, Taos Health Systems would be able to leverage that, I think, very successfully with that loan fund that you're referring to. But you need the stream of revenue, you need the guarantee. Nobody's going to lend you money without guaranteed stream of revenue. I'm sorry.
And Mr. Chairman, is mill levy the only source of money that we have available? Are there other options that we can tap into where it would be more equitable to Taos Annuals, where someone, including visitors to the Taos area, could pay?
The Health Support Act is a state statute, and that allows only for the mill levy. And it is the vehicle that is used throughout the state of New Mexico. And I do believe that a majority of the counties have employed it to help their hospitals survive. Obviously, you can always suggest a gross receipts tax to the public. It would be obviously not under the Health Support Act, but Leandro can tell us what those sources are.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, yes, unfortunately, Taos County has given up the GRT increment specific for helping a hospital. We swapped that out for our educational GRT that's out there. Of course, there's the other GRTs we've talked about that are available, but I would again caution enacting it to leverage for another entity. We do need to remember that we're quite a bit smaller than the hospital overall. So, you know, sometimes it's ironic that we come seeking a lot of help when our budget is a lot smaller than the hospital's budget. The county doesn't have the revenues that the hospital does. At this time, probably the revenue source that hasn't been tapped into would be the mill levy, and GRT would be a tough one, but we could possibly frame it.
So, Mr. Chairman, what I would like to see is what the average height would be for average properties, as you saw in the article in the newspaper this week in the headlines on unsolved waste itself. There's a lot of people who can't necessarily afford to pay $125 a year. How are they going to afford to pay a higher property tax? And unfortunately, it's within my district areas, and District 5 and District 2, that these areas are the ones that are more prone not to pay for those extra expenses or cost of living.
The property would have to be worth $400,000 for it to equal the $125 a year. So So it's $33 per $100,000.
So you're saying then that it would affect a certain sector, a certain value?
Yeah, if you know, it costs the public $125 a year for the waste fee, anybody paying $125 additional under a mill levy, their property would have to be worth $400,000. So in that...
And Mr. Chairman, those are the things that I think are very important for our public to know in order for them to support that. And I understand that we, as a body of county commissioners, cannot promote it just present it and place it before the electorate and let them make that decision. But I really believe that we have to educate the public as much as possible as to who it is going to affect or not.
I agree. I think that's an important point. And
is that not to be successful?
Yeah. So, Bill, what are your thoughts on that? If this board did vote to put it to the electorate, what would the campaign look like?
We would see that we would have huge responsibility to make sure it was successful. So the way that we've thought about this is we would start with our employees and their family members. We would make sure that we reached out to the businesses as well as the community overall. So it would be a three-part strategy: our employees, our business community, and then the general electorate. And we would use every means available to us. We would use media, print, radio. We would use face-to-face sessions. So it would be as an aggressive a campaign on a shoestring budget as we could put together.
Would you be spending some evenings at the house like it?
One or two.
Mr. Malone.
This isn't a formal timeline, but just as some kind of framework for the discussion about a timeline, we're already at a point right now where the earliest that any, it would have to be a special election to make it early, but the earliest that any election could be held would be in 2016 anyway, even if we started the process today. And so we're into 2016 and all of the consequences of that regardless. The first scheduled election is the primary in June. And so, again, that's in 2016. If we're trying to make it happen quicker than that, then acting quickly becomes important. If we're talking about piggybacking with the existing primary election, which avoids the cost of a special election, then there's no urgency in doing it in the next 3 or 4 weeks. We've got plenty of time to make it happen before the primary in June.
Right. But that brings another interesting point, which we have discussed in the past. I think Ms. Martinez has informed us that generally for these types of elections, special elections are used. And
those are costly.
They are costly, but the costs would be handled by the hospital. And I think that there are a number of reasons why you would choose to do a special election rather than a primary, but it seems to be pretty much generally accepted that if you're going to do it, you should do it in a special election and not a primary. Which brings me to the question, what would be the earliest date for a special election? And I guess either Bob or...
Well, again, I can give you a rough kind of estimate. I can't give you a precise timeline, but we would have to put on a commission agenda a resolution to call the election, and that's going to take us 2 to 4 weeks to do that if we started right away with the idea of a resolution. Then, and Anna, you can correct me on this, but roughly there's a specific 56-day requirement, but when you put in the slot, it's easier to say that that's 60 to 70 days. So, you know, if we started from the time the resolution passes, we're into, if we started right away, we're into January or February. Mm-hmm. That's roughly correct, Anna?
No, it's correct.
Mm-hmm. I think we need to take that route. I don't think that it's prudent or desirable to wait. And the notion that we're going to wait until we see what the Taos Health Systems does with their contract doesn't really seem appropriate to me. I appreciate the press release. I appreciate the negotiations that are going on. I think that it's a good direction for THS to take. I think that the directions that Bill and others have outlined regarding use of beds and recruitment all make really good sense and are important to improving what we have here. But the only way we're going to survive is to utilize the Health Support Act that most other counties utilize. And it's critical to the health of the citizens, it's critical to the economy. I can't think of any more important institution that we have to address. And so, any one of us can do this, of course. It has nothing to do with me being chairman. Any one of us can bring it on an agenda. My inclination is to bring it sooner than later. Commissioner Romero.
Mr. Chairman, I agree, and maybe what we ought to do to start with is have a work-study session where we can allow an entire morning or an entire day to this discussion. And I would suggest that it would be done sometime before Thanksgiving, if at all possible, this work-study session between Taos County and the hospital, so that we can set up a timeline and become a little bit more aware of what those numbers are and what the needs are. We have all that on paper for the public to see as well.
Thank you, Commissioner. I'd be in favor of that. Mr. Cordova?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, we were planning to do a November 10th on our legislative initiatives. Would you like us to maybe do the afternoon as a work study for the hospital? This time, I mean, that would probably be the best scheduling for us to get it before Thanksgiving. Things are getting, it'll be Thanksgiving before you know it, and since this is already scheduled, I think that might be our.
This is November 10th, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
November 10th, we haven't announced that yet?
No, we're just finalizing the agenda, so
okay,
we could still make that work. It'll be next Tuesday, so we'll have to have the agenda out by Friday. We'd like to have any thing that the hospital is going to present by Friday.
Does that work for THS?
Yes, we can do that.
All right, we have a plan. Commissioner O'Donnell.
Mr. Chairman, my concern is you rush this, will be a repeat of the judicial complexes. It may not pass because they haven't had enough time to have their community meetings to really explain it. My concern is if we rush it, that it may not pass similarly to the complex that took it to pass quite. It took twice. So.
All right. Commissioners, anything further from THS? Well, then we'll look forward to November 10th and delve into this a little more, and hopefully we'll be able to get it on the agenda after that and make decisions.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, move for a 7-minute break.
7-minute break.
Coffee break? Absolutely.
I'll second that.
Vice Chair Fendrell.
Okay.
Commissioner Little.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blakenhorn.
Yes. We have a motion to come back in session.
Second.
Comfortable.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. Good morning, Earl.
Good morning.
You're up for a presentation on a road. I can't remember the name now.
Doniana?
Yeah, this is your Doniana presentation, and then we'll move into the contractual.
Okay.
Sounds
good. On the Doña Ana Road, we have the engineer that went out there and performed all the survey. He has it all marked down. He had a family emergency that he had to be away for a week and a half. I talked to him yesterday, he's back on that. He said that he should be done by this Friday with the rest of the paperwork. At that time, we will find out if the road belongs to landowners or if it just belongs to a private owner or who he belongs to. And we'll take it from there to see what we need to go to move forward.
Any thoughts on what improvements, when all of this paperwork is done, as to what improvements you may be able to do on that particular area?
It's a short 300 feet, so I'm sure we can just go in there, grade it, shape it up, and maybe just shape it up is probably what he needs because he has some pretty decent bit run on it.
The hope was that from the residents in that area, it affects probably about 10 families, is that it could be done before winter, but I think it's still something that needs to be come before the commission, even go before the road years.
Right. And I talked to the residents too, and I made them aware that it does take longer than we hope, but with a little bit of patience, we should be on there hopefully late December, early January at the most.
Is it something that you can work on in the winter time?
Oh, yeah. And again, depending on weather, some winters we have good weather, some winters we not so good, but being that it's a short distance, I think we won't have a problem.
Okay.
And that's the road that will be considered to add to our inventory?
Yes, but also it could be something where we could work jointly with the town of Taos, as you said, Mr. Salazar, that, you know, when we were out there one day, that if the town is sweeping snow on their road already from Highway 68 to the end of Doña Ana Road, just beyond the spot, that they use that county area, that little loop to be able to turn their trucks or whatever equipment they
right.
have.
They
could hit it, clean it, do some little bit of maintenance
right.
at the time that they're there.
And vice versa, if we go in there
right.
and just drop our blade going in all the way until we sweep it up and comes right out. It'll be for the benefit of all residents.
Yeah.
How about the two that we have added, Tres Lomas and Santa Esteban?
We were waiting on all the survey, on all the
easements,
right, yeah.
So they're all turned in?
Those are all.
They're all those are in the process of filing the plat stat.
Okay, well, that's our last step is recording with those. I talked to Shannon, I talked to Martin Chavez. I mean, and they're anxiously awaiting even a blade down the road will be great.
Right.
As soon as Bobek gets his stuff and has a second to get those recorded,
and
a big party out there for you and everybody in the room.
We'll tell Earl as soon as they report. They'll be reporting this week.
And again, it's going to take a process of, you know, getting all the line locates. We got to make sure we get all our line locates, all our gas locates before we start going in there with the blade. And measuring out, make sure we stay in our easement. And so before we get a blade in there, it's gonna take a little bit of prep to get it going. But if we don't snow,
Well, the prep alone will be a show to the people that we're on it.
Right.
And so with the recordings this week, hopefully towards the end of this week, maybe even, you know, we can get some spotters out there. Just seeing some paint along the sides of the road
right.
will make people
right.
encouraged.
Once they know that it is adopted, I'm sure they're going to jump with joy.
They are. So, Mr. Chairman, with regards to Doña Ana, if we can develop, I'm a big fan of timelines, just some sort of a timeline schedule as to how things are going to happen so that I can report that to the constituents in my district.
And again, once we get paperwork from the surveyors and get back to getting it recorded and making sure we get all the easements, I'm honestly saying January, mid-January.
At this point, are you foreseeing any problems with the easement situation?
I don't know. I haven't seen no paperwork.
Okay.
Mr. Malone,
refresh my memory. We haven't had a formal commission vote on adopting Doña Ana.
Correct.
And have the road years gone out yet, Earl?
Yes, sir.
They have. So from the
legal side, once I get the survey, the road bureau's report and the survey has to be filed. It has to be on file 10 days before the commission can consider it. So that will establish the timeline.
This is a good question. And it'll expedite the matter just a little bit more.
And we can give them a better time.
Great. Well, we know you like adding new roads to your inventory, so. All right, off we go to 10. Item 10, this is contracts, and A is a discussion and decision regarding the approval of amendment to the co-op agreement and for a time extension ending June 30th, 2016.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I respect the public coming before you to ask for extension on the First Amendment to, of the corporate agreement. We are asking for a 6 month extension. The engineers informed us that they would not be ready by the deadline we had in December. And they have the survey and they're working on the design as we speak. And they would be thinking that their timeline would be mid-January. So we'd ask that if we could go all the way to June so we could have enough time to get all the paperwork, all the information, weather permitting, all the whole bag.
Which road is this?
This is Camino de Medio San Cristobal.
What is the length of it?
1.7 miles, if I remember correctly. I was, Mr. Chairman, if I may, I was a little confused reading the report. It's just for surveying and engineering. It's not for actual road work, correct?
Correct.
That has to be bid out.
Yes. And this project, we would probably go that route, bid it out. There's going to be a lot of specifics to this project, the drainage and the fixes that they are identifying through the engineering is going to require probably more specific RFP on this. And it'll probably be phases. So the next phase is probably going to attack the drainage and culverts and ground and working on fixing the problem that is causing the issues first, and then the final phase will have to be paving completion of it. But we may not see that this next year, we may not see that for the following year.
So right now the road's in pretty bad shape, I take it? It doesn't have culverts, what's the
It has culverts crossing the Acequia, has a culvert, and then there's a couple of road culverts. But what's happening is all the rock, mountain rocks and stuff are coming in, and they're draining out, and they're draining into the Acequias, and they're draining into properties. So we're trying to figure out how to get the drainage to go to where it needs to get relocated.
Kind of like a Banyano San Juan.
I'm sorry, Mr. Malone?
Just to be clear, the commission at its last meeting passed a resolution to extend the date. This is just the contract from NMDOT confirming that.
Okay.
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Zambro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. On to item B, this is a discussion and decision regarding approval of the First Amendment to the co-op agreement. This reads a lot like the last one.
It's the same thing, but a separate LG.
LGRF.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Second, Mr. Chairman. Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. Thank you, Earl.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Item 11, resolutions A, this is a discussion decision regarding approval of resolution 2015-58, designated precinct locations and official polling places within Taos County.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's glad to say Anna, but.
So this is a resolution just requesting that you approve our polling places. They are all the same with the exception of number 33, the ski valley, that's going to be moved to the UNM-Taos ski valley due to the construction that's happening up there. But other than that, they're all the same.
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Romero?
Yes.
I'm sorry, Commissioner Romero, Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. On to item 11, resolutions, discussion decision regarding resolution. Oh no, I did that. This is A. That was A. We've already done that. And now we're done. So now we go to item 12A, Department Matters. This is a discussion and ratification of approval for the engineering on Community Medio. Mr. Cordova.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I can just do this from here. Basically, it's in regards to the same project we've been discussing all morning. Because we've already procured the contract with WH Pacific, we are allowed to do task orders that are specific to projects. Because the total cost of this is $70,115, I'm being here before you guys for approval in order to get the contract approved and finalize the work.
Mr. Chairman, there's no price increase, is that correct?
No.
Commissioners, we have a motion to approve this.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. On the 13, Budget Matters A, this is a discussion and decision regarding approval of DFA Resolution 8, 2015-16 fiscal year, and it's a resolution requesting an adjustment to the final budget to properly account for the lodger's tax revenue refunding and improvement bonds. Ms. Lupe Martinez, good morning.
Good morning. Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I come before you regarding DFA resolution. This is basically to establish the funds associated with the refinance recently done with the lodger's tax loan. This specific DFA resolution affects six different budgets that are attached to DFA resolution, and I hereby recommend approval.
Thank you, Lupe. Commissioners, any questions, motions?
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
I'll second with discussion.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, Ms. Martinez, we got a list of unspent appropriations from the legislature. Included in that is $80,000 for the 4-H arena. And so I'm wondering, some of this money will be spent to improve the Ag Center, correct? Is that correct? And so this $80,000, we don't know if it's been spent or if it's...
We do know, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, that'll be part of our update on the November 10th, but a lot of the appropriation that you saw have been expended. The report LFC gave was as of September, and we have probably spent most of the money over the summer and are currently seeking reimbursement. And so until they finally give us the reimbursement and update their system, we won't show that we've expended it. But for the most part, we certainly have attacked, especially the oldest ones that are looking to be reverted. Those are spent, Settle Community Center, and the 4-H.
So the 4-H has been spent then? Because I was hoping we could add it to the improvement package.
I'll let Mr. Sanchez go. Most of it has. I think if there's any remaining, it will be part of the overall additional money.
Currently, we spent about 50% of that on the sprinkler system, and we are going to have to go into design work for the completion of the addition. So we're talking to architects right now. We're going to get quotes for the design work and use some of that money for the design work and for some more of the utility hookups. But at least, I want to say $40,000 has probably already been spent for the tri-pipe fire suppression over the seating area in the arena.
So then can we just kind of augment that? You have $40,000, can we add to the improvements?
I guess we can add the financial aspect of it, that's as much as our manager, but my understanding is we were going to use it for design to progress further with the total project because you have to have updated plans in order to put it out to bid for the construction side.
And the hookups, correct?
And for some of the hookups, yes.
$40,000 be enough? That's why I was wondering if we can piggyback some of this new loan money to finish the 4-H arena.
The new loan money is going to be booked to finish it. The $45,000 will probably pay for utility hookups and the design work required to get up-to-date plans. And then the full amount that we're getting in the refinancing would be used to offer construction costs.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, yes, we are using it in conjunction with this money. We're moving it out the door, and I think that's, at the end of the day, what I want to be able to report to you on the 10th is we are making great progress. And even LFC does acknowledge the way they classify everything within Taos County. It makes Taos County look like we may not be moving on our specific appropriations, but I do We're confident that we are moving on. We are certainly getting those monies out the door.
Thank you. And I would like the record to show, and Mr. Hooks, you're in the audience, that list is skewed because of different agencies. And I'm going to find out if there's certain mutual domestics in my district, if they spent that money, if they haven't spent it, you know, if they need help. I think hopefully by the 10th we'll kind of have a real picture of what Taos County has spent and has not spent. Thank you so much for doing that.
Commissioner
Fembro. Along those lines, Commissioner O'Donnell, last week it was talked a lot with the manager and myself were in outreach about the $50 million that we have for the possible LIDA and other projects, and we found out that the part of that money can be asked for the courthouse, because the plaza renovation and plaza projects are part of that $50 million that the legislature gave the Economic Development Department last year. And so we've set up the initial contact to see how much of that we could borrow or be gap funding, or there's about four different ways that we can use that money, so we're trying to get that in the process before, since they haven't used any of the $50 million, there's rumor that it could be clawed back, but we're hoping to at least get our say-so in it right away.
That's really good news. And Commissioner O'Donnell, I couldn't agree with you more. Those mutuals, you know, each of us, I think, needs to work with them. I know that Commissioner Romero already does, but all right.
I'm sorry we're deviating, but regarding a neighborhood association in my district that had a water leak over in Camino Santiago area, they're a homeowners association, and Mr. Pacheco, when he was still alive, recommended they stay a homeowners instead of a mutual domestic, which I do not understand the reasoning. But here you've got 27 homes, you know, elderly people. They're going to have to pay for that water line break. And they're debating, where do they go? Do they hook up to the town? Do we create a new mutual regional wastewater treatment? I mean, it's these problems are really epidemic.
Yeah, it's a big topic.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I know we are meeting, but just so you are aware, I get those questions all the time from the county, whether we would take over mutual domestics. At this point, my answer is Taos County isn't in the water business, but I think we are able to be committed to bringing everyone together. And so what I'm going to work on in the new year is maybe a water summit where we can bring every player to the table. We have some really unique entities like the water and sanitation districts, and Abeyta being one that's a great example of what is already working. As the county, I think we could be the glue, but we probably aren't going to be that mechanism to do water at this time. But I do think we can bring everyone together, and that's something I'm going to work on either right before the new year or right after the new year.
Excellent approach. Look forward to it in January. We do have a motion and a second on the table. Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blakenhorn?
Yes. Now we have a item 13B. This is a discussion decision regarding approval of VFA resolution. Requesting an adjustment of the final budget to account for the federal subgrant agreement from the Department of Homeland Security. Lupe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, DFA resolution, what it does is it establishes a new grant Taos County has received. Our E91 director has received this grant for the hiring of an emergency management coordinator position for Taos County. The amount of the grant is $61,530. Attached to this DFA resolution, you will find a budget establishing the new fund, which basically changes our chart of accounts, so it accounts for that. You will find a copy of the subgrant agreement, and you will find a copy of the job description that the commissioners recently approved about a month ago. And I recommend approval.
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Second discussion. Is this for Mr. Martinez's job? Does this create a second job?
It creates a second job. So right now, Mr. Martinez is the E911 coordinator and he is the OEM director. This position is basically going to be a coordinator for the OEM department. which we had it, we have a split salary going on right now, so this is basically a one-year term. This position extends through the fiscal year, so it doesn't end on June 30th, it goes through September. So you'll see activity for it for next fiscal year also.
And we can reapply?
Hopefully we can reapply.
So does that relieve Mr. Martinez of his duties?
No.
Or he still oversees Homeland Security, will oversee this person?
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
And it's my understanding you've already conducted interviews?
Yes, Commissioner, we have conducted interviews last week.
And you're close to making a recommendation?
Correct. We're going, I'll be visiting with Mr. Corwin about this so we can see what we're gonna do.
Thank you.
We have a motion and a second on the table. No further discussion, please call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. On to item C, and this is a discussion and decision regarding a budget adjustment for the Human Resources Department.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, since the beginning of the fiscal year, Taos County has hired 23 full-time employees and 9 casual employees. Ms. Weber, our Human Resources Director, has done a great job doing the illustration. Do you want to put that illustration up, please? With this illustration, she has identified the cost associated with hiring a new employee for orientation. Since that illustration, she does recommend that we allocate additional budget in the amount of $7,000 into other contractual services to cover the new hire orientation process for Taos County employees. She will be taking the money out from professional services, and I recommend approval.
Motion to approve. I will second, Mr. Chairman.
Call for the vote.
Vice Chairman Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn?
Yes. On to item D, and this is a discussion decision regarding a budget adjustment for the fire excise tax. Hondo Seco, Fire Department.
I'm handing you something that was attached to this agenda item, and I will go back to my section. Hondo Seco Volunteer Fire Department has asked permission from State Fire Marshal Office for the purchase of a 2016 tender. This is going to be a wildland apparatus, and the request was sent to Rudy Padilla, who is the inspector for the fire department. What the letter that I handed to you basically does acknowledge the approval for the purchase of this vehicle. The expense is going to basically come from the fire protection monies, the bulk of it. This money is needed to cover the expense. Right now in the fire protection budget, Joaquin Gonzalez has $113,000. The vehicle that they are looking to get is $127,000. So this $20,000 is going to be from the fire excise tax to cover the difference of the vehicle purchase.
Mr. Chairman, and on here it indicates the fire station shall have the adequate space needed to properly house this vehicle. Do we have the adequate space in this area?
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, I don't think so. I think it's something that we come up in the past, and they've actually requested to do an addition to the building, and I don't think that's been completed. I don't have any more specifics on this. Unfortunately, Mr. Gonzalez, our fire chief, is on vacation this week, and I think Ms. Martinez was corresponding with Hondo Seco directly, and I think this is the latest that we got from them in terms of their explanation. So I can't answer that. They don't have the space as far as I'm aware. I don't know where they might be planning to put this.
So Mr. Chairman, would they be retiring any of their vehicles?
What the request is before you today is basically just to allocate the budget. They still will have to come before the commissioners for the actual purchase. And at that time, those questions can be asked then of the fire chief or our Hondo Seco representatives.
Is there a timeline on this?
No, this is what we're doing right now is basically just establishing a budget for the purchase. They'll still have to come before you. The approval letter was dated October 9th from the State Fire Marshal's Office.
Mr. Chair, Commissioner Fembro. Most likely, guessing only, this is going to replace something. Rudy would not have approved it had they not given him the issue to that they're going to. And Joaquin could be moving one of their older apparatus to another county department. Joaquin has that ability to do that, so I'm suspecting that that will happen because Hondo Seco is the most active of the county departments, so they would need probably the newer stuff, and Joaquin would have the ability to move any of their existing fleet amongst any of the other departments as he sees fit. So to get this far, and then to keep in mind, the quickest that you're going to get a fire truck from today would be 6 to 8 months. If it's a custom pumper, you're looking at 15 months. So I think this is just getting their ducks in a row. This is the first step from the State Fire Marshal's office. So it's probably, I'd be willing to bet Joaquin's got it figured somewhere that they're currently, I do realize they do not have room, but I'm thinking he's going to move something.
With that, I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second, Mr. Chairman.
Call for the vote.
Vice Chair Fambro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes. On to item E, and this is a discussion and decision regarding approval of the budget adjustment for the Veterans Cemetery.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, this budget adjustment is basically to allocate additional budget into professional services. Most of the budget was put into buildings and structures. We still are having to get engineering services done, and this is basically to put $75 million into professional services to allow for the engineers to complete their work on this project. This is just the first part of this project. There's still another $100,000 grant out there that we are not touching yet, and that will be basically dedicated for the buildings and structures of that Veterans Cemetery. And I recommend approval.
Mr. Chairman, any updates on what has happened there?
I will give you that.
Very good. Just for approval, Mr. Chairman. Second.
With discussion. Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Commissioner O'Donnell.
We just approved $42,000 3 months ago. And now, coming back and he's saying he needs more money. I think this should have been a contract amendment. This kind of opened, if we can, sign a contract and then they come back in 3 months and ask for more money. I'm a little concerned about this. I don't know if I like this.
Mr. Chairman, you would have to remove the money first before you could do the contracts on this.
Are you going to do a contract amendment?
Right.
We would have to, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, we would have to have it come before legal at this time yet, as I am aware, but this is just the first step of allocating the funds before we would go that route. So yes, we would have to increase the contract, and that would have to come before you ask for that permission, being that it's over the procurement amount. So I will follow up with that. I'll let you know, and it might be with the other next meeting for approval.
Commissioner O'Donnell? Mr. Malone?
Mr. Chairman, it might be an amendment if it was further work that was already contracted for and there was some reason for an amendment. It might be an entirely new contract, depending upon what the original contract covered. I don't have the answer to that. I don't know what he's proposing to do with this money, but it may be work that wasn't originally contracted for.
Do you know? Because it sounds like...
Let's look at the second page of this budget adjustment. And let's go into the detail of it. So towards the end of the budget adjustment, you will see that right now there is an unencumbered balance of $3,000. The contract professional services coming before the commissioners in a future meeting is another $3,700. So in order for me to accommodate the negative right now and to allocate additional budget for $3,700 more, I am asking for the $7,500. This is grant specific, so it is an allowable expense. And all we're doing right now today is just basically allocating the budget. Any amendments will come before the commissioners for consideration.
So, Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, it looks like what we were forced to do at the time of the contract approval was to push the budget into a negative, and now we're fixing that. So we're just getting the budget to equal the amount of the contract you've already approved. And then with a little additional money for a buffer, but we haven't asked for that yet. So the additional money is there in case, which it probably has been indicated there may be a little bit of extra work needed, that would come back for you, back to you for final approval. But at this time, it hasn't been requested.
And staff will take a very critical look, of course, at any requests for increases in contracts and bring back recommendations to the board.
Mr. Chairman, if I could on this subject, please. Myself and Commissioner Romero visited with our congressional delegation on this to to try to get the designation changed back to us, which is something that we really cannot overlook that much longer, and I suggest that we continue with our efforts to get the federal assistance on this project and getting the designation before we get too much further into it and calling it what it appropriately should be. We need to get that finalized. So I think we need to do some visiting to get some more money for a little bit and move around to get this thing going the way it needs to go.
Yeah, especially since we have like 100 grand and the wall is supposed to cost 300. That's just the wall, the fence.
Time is right. I think we need to get them up again.
I agree. Do we have a motion?
So you're just moving money around. We're not actually approving.
No, it's just budget.
All right, thank you.
And we do have a motion and a second. Please call for the vote.
Vice Chair Fembro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes.
Thank you.
And thank you, Lupe, and thank you, Richard, for getting out there and doing that work on the sagebrush. All right, on to the really interesting portion of the agenda. We have item 14, County Manager's Report. And he's gone. Oh, there he is.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, thank you. So we're busy. We're always busy at the county, but we've been very busy the last few months, trying to get a lot of things tackled, trying to get prepared for legislative session earlier than we have. We're trying to complete projects from the fall moving into the winter. So I have a few items today to discuss. I may not cover everything with you, but I'm going to try and get through a few things that we've been working on. Number one, starting around the budget preparation time in the spring, we began the process of looking at healthcare options for our employees. We started shopping and looking for different agencies that can help us go through this process. We kind of interviewed a couple different agencies and we decided to go with Brown & Brown, who have a local presence here in Taos, and they've been moving along relatively quickly. And so very soon here, I'm gonna come back to the commission with a lot more detail. We have a big meeting Friday to go over a lot of actual detail, but what it means is it looks like we can save money. We can save money for the county, and most importantly, we can save money for our employees. What's important to us at management and the management level is that we don't take anything away from the employees in terms of the benefits they actually receive, and that we don't add any costs to their out-of-pocket and deductibles and the kind of things that the county doesn't share with them, but they have to incur when they go out to the doctor. So we are looking at some great opportunity, and the preliminary numbers we've gotten do save money. And so at this point, we're just working out the details, and I just wanted to inform the commission as to that. We need to meet with our local union rep, Ms. Paras, as we have more details so that we can involve them and just get them to understand the initiative that we're taking on. And then upon recommendation from management, we'll come back to ask you for the first step, which is leading the risk management pool. That's a 90-day process. So, you know, as soon as we're ready to come back to you for that, we will. And I'll come ask for that permission to remove us from risk management. So, if you have any questions on that?
Mr. Chairman, who do we use now for insurance?
Currently, we go through the state. It's risk management, which is a division of GSD, General Services Department. We've seen nothing but increases over the last few years. Every year we can guarantee at least a 3% increase, sometimes as much as 10%. And in the last couple of years, we've had a change with the administration of this. Risk management's brought in a third party called ERISA that has made things a little bit more complicated and certainly more frustrating for finance staff to reconcile with them when we're constantly going back and forth. And so, you know, the combination of that, the frustration we have to deal with, just have them take our money and apply it the right way, plus the increase year after year, really pushed us to start looking at this as an alternative. And we're moving. Now we're really close to making a decision and taking it to the next step. So that's why I wanted to alert the commission at this time. And I want to thank staff for the hard work they've done, HR, finance. It's a daunting task, and we're very thankful for Brown & Brown being a partner in this stuff as well. So, any other questions on that topic? If not, moving on, I just wanted to report, Mr. Bill Wade has resigned from our Arts and Artifacts Committee. We don't have to fill the position at this time, and if the commission wants to reappoint or wait until January when you do all your appointments, that would probably work. He has a letter that can share that with the commission. I think his time was there to move on, and he was grateful and he is thankful to the county, and he has done a lot for the Arts and Artifacts Committee, and we do want to thank him for the time and the service that he has provided.
Mr. Corn, that was my appointee, correct?
I do believe so.
Mr. Chairman, can we send a thank you letter or something?
Certainly. Thank you.
Good idea.
Moving on, next point, just to let you know, staff is working hard diligently on closing out our 2015 CDBG grant. We've been meeting with DFA, local government, our representative has been here in Taos a few times, and we're getting real close in order to be able to meet the threshold for the next project. So we're really pushing to get this complete so that we can start moving forward on the next project. That next project will be something we'll discuss on November 10th, something that we really want to get all the commission's input on as we move forward. The next point, getting on to the veterans. The veterans had their meeting regarding the conceptual plans for the front entrance. That took place this last Friday. Approximately 40 veterans were in attendance. Mr. Henry told the veterans that he welcomes their input on the design of the cemetery and that he will be designing it to federal standards. Some updates on the progress. We have submitted the permit with all the requirements, and it looks pretty good at this time. We've also, along a parallel path, had the property staked, and Public Works has actually begun doing a little bit of grading to help facilitate the movement of the machinery that's coming from Amalia to help us do the project. So we are moving forward. I think that should be able to be completed, and weather seems to be working with us at this time, so I think it must be a positive. We might be able to get it done by then, we hope. So we're really moving towards getting it complete.
You got 48 hours.
On another note, based on some of the designs, the road being a major aspect of the design, we have talked to Public Works, and it looks like they may be able to try and take that on as a project within the county. It should save us a lot of money and get us a lot of progress and get our guys some experience on building a good quality road. And so I think that's another thing we'll probably start working on a lot more in the springtime, but it's another way for us to save money and get that money back into the perimeter fencing that needs to be done. There was also a couple of requests, mainly from Mr. Cordova, to meet with the governors of the Pueblos. He would like to set up meetings with Taos Pueblo and Picolis Pueblo. He has the contact at Taos, and I called the governor from Picolis this morning so that we can share our idea and hopefully get some support, and you know, maybe some federal support from these two entities that might help get that designation here and get some funding maybe through that. So that was a good idea from the veterans that day coming out of that meeting. And I stand any questions on that.
Commissioner Romero. Mr. Chairman, thank you so much for that report, Mr. Cordova. I was wondering, the Inga Fire was the designated location by the governor's office. I believe that after an extensive interview, have they received any funding yet? Is that the reason why they have not started? That I'm aware of, they have not started any or done any groundbreaking. They haven't gone as far as we have. And it would be really good to let the governor know that we are forging forward with our veterans project, the cemetery project, and it would be really great for her to change her mind. Somehow keep her aware of what is going on in Taos County already.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Romero, I am not aware of Vigil Fire's progress, but I can commit to making sure that we let everybody at the state level know how much work we put in. And so during our legislative session, I will do our best to promote Taos County and, you know, be a cheerleader on this project for all of us to show that we are really actively working towards this so that we can get that designation moved over.
Okay, thank you.
I think I remember that the state designation was just the first step, and then you had another hurdle, and that Angel Fire didn't make that. So I think
think that was the case.
So that helps us to a good extent. You know, as Commissioner Fabro indicated, we need to continue that conversation with our congressional delegation as well.
They're very responsive and
yeah.
ask us to follow up, and I think the time is now.
Okay. So no more questions or discussion on that topic. I want to move on next to an update about the tours of the detention center across the street. I think most of you have had the opportunity, except for Commissioner Fabro and Commissioner Gallegos, to go over there. Because we're waiting on those two, we'll probably move the discussion to our next meeting. And I know that there's a lot of discussion to be had on it, so we're looking forward to that, and just want to give the last two commissioners the opportunity to get in there and take their tour. Next, I wanted to talk a little bit about where I was last week. I had the opportunity to attend the Infrastructure Finance Conference with Commissioner Fabro, but before that, on Tuesday afternoon and Wednesday morning, I attended the LFC hearings in Santa Fe. Tuesday afternoon, the topic was healthcare, and they did go into a lot of discussion, a lot of different recommendations from LFC and many aspects of healthcare. A lot of it did come back around to Medicaid and Medicaid funding and how to make sure we maximize that 3-to-1 match. And of course, one of the recommendations coming from LFC, it's nothing new, but it certainly does affect counties, and I just kind of wanted to read it to you. I have this whole packet. I'm going to go ahead and have Renell or Lisa scan this in and email it to you guys so you can take a look at it. But basically, one of the recommendations, the legislature should consider amending the Indigent Hospital and County Healthcare Act to require counties contribute gross receipts tax revenue from the Healthcare Assistance Fund, formerly County Indigent Fund, as an intergovernmental transfer to leverage federal Medicaid matching funds for the purpose of funding uncompensated care at federally qualified health centers and public health offices. The funds should not revert, and also require counties to provide DFA, local government division, and HSD quarterly financial statements on the status of their healthcare assistance funds. What I heard was they're going after some more of our county money, and I wasn't the only one that heard that. Representative Dodge out of Santa Rosa happens to be Guadalupe County manager, and I had the opportunity to talk to him at IFC a little bit. He heard the same thing. I think we need to be diligent in what we're doing with our money. We certainly need to get our programs out there as quickly as possible. And what is unfortunate, in my opinion, is instead of the state coming up to the level that we need to make the most out of the 3-to-1 match, we just shorted everybody because the counties didn't do what they hoped we would do and give them the whole 1-8. And I think that's probably something that should have, I think the purpose of not doing a whole 1-8 is to get the state to try and step up, and they haven't. They're still trying to get the counties and local governments to do what they got to do. One promising part of that discussion that I thought might require some more thought and maybe NMAC could help us with is the idea of getting the difference into our local public health offices or local health initiatives and still get a 3-to-1 match. So in other words, taking our last entity or the last little bit of funds that are left and just giving it to local entities and giving them the opportunity to get that leverage. So as an example, we're able to give $100,000 to the public health building, they should be able to receive $300,000 from the 3-to-1 match, similar to what we had experienced in the past with the hospital. That hasn't been worked out in terms of details and how that's going to be done, but to me that was the most promising discussion that I think we could maybe support at this level, because the funds are used specifically for healthcare, but it stays in our community and we get to help those entities get more. And so that was one thing I thought was promising, and one thing that in discussion with Mr. Copelman at NMAC, I think they're going to also pursue that as a maybe an alternative resolution to some of these fights that we've been having on this subject.
The best way to keep the state from taking that money is for us to put it to good use. And we've got nearly $2 million in an indigent fund, and we still haven't seen the RFP.
And on that, Mr. Chairman, you will see that RFP within the next 2 weeks. We've worked on that diligently. There was reasons for taking a long time in the initial aspect, and it talking with some other counties that maybe rolled it out a little soon. They're experiencing some issues with auditors and getting, you know, some scrutiny from these auditors and not having the proper plan on how they were going to do it once it was initiated. And so I think we are being conservative as always, but I hope it'll help us at the back end not get punished for pushing it too fast.
I know we're going to hold off on the discussion regarding our visit to the detention center, but just in relation to the indigent fund, we don't have any programs for any of those guys, and that money could be used for programs. Mental health, physical health, I would love to see some proposals along those lines, and I guess the RFP is going to be general enough to include that?
Yes, the RFP should be general enough to allow for those options. Something else we have been working on is our indigent care coordinator, Ms. Jaramillo, has been going over to the detention center a few times a week, working with medical over there and the director to get the list of patients that may be qualified as indigent to help cover some of our costs. But from that, the discussion has come up about the necessity for a case manager, somebody that serves as a liaison in between our detention center and the outside world, and to get our detainees the best footing when they get out of there and get help and do what we can to carry them past the detention center, out of it, and hopefully not come back in. And I think that's something that we can use this money to maybe fund and get that coordinator moving, and then that coordinator could also maybe be our liaison if we do finalize a committee of citizens, a citizen action committee for the detention center. So those are, I appreciate your concern and any thoughts on that, I welcome them, but we are hearing the same thing, and I think we're moving in that direction because it's obvious that we have the capacity to do more.
Great.
And so the next day at LFC was about capital outlay. And so, you know, we've had a lot of this talk. I do need to get back to Mr. Hooks with the Taos News. I wanted to give him some more detail, but I'm in preparation of going to listen to this LFC. Commissioner Romero had given me a list that he had received from back in June. We were able to look at some of these numbers, and unfortunately it does paint Taos County in somewhat of a negative light in not being able to move the older appropriations we have. But when you break down the list to just what Taos County has, we are on top of our list. We have moved diligently through that. We had a hiccup a year and a half ago when we had a bad audit and we weren't able to be our own fiscal agent. We've moved past that, and this last year we really spent a lot of money. Over the summer we spent a lot of money that's just waiting to be reimbursed. And so November 10th we'll go into detail on all those projects. We'll let you see what's left on every one of those appropriations, especially the older ones. At IFC, at the Infrastructure Finance Conference, we had the ability to listen to DFA talk about the future of administering these. And they have a process that they want to implement, which I felt was a very positive thing because there really wasn't a central process for this at DFA in the past. So now knowing what that process is means that we can learn it and follow it, and everything should be more consistent, and we know exactly where something's hung up. In the past, unfortunately, something might get hung up between us and DFA, and it was just back and forth. Well, you were supposed to get us this, we don't have proof that you got it. This process doesn't allow for excuses, is how I see it. And I think that's a positive step going forward. They're also fully staffed at DFA for the first time in 3 years, which I think is a positive step as well. And so our senator asked some good questions of LFC at that hearing about Taos County and how it does look like the county as a whole isn't, and who is actually holding on to the money. And it does look like it is smaller entities, mutual domestics, acequias, the kind of entities that needed the money, but they may not have gotten everything they needed, so they got a piecemeal perhaps, so they're waiting for another tranche to be able to do a project. They may have had an audit issue based on the executive order because they're smaller entities, they weren't able to address it quickly enough. And sometimes it's just capacity. Their volunteer board sometimes running these things, and they just don't have the sophistication and the capacity to administer this kind of grant in a timely manner. And so I think on that, it's another opportunity for the county to kind of be the central glue on how to do this and how to help coach these smaller entities, or maybe even be the fiscal agent for some of them in their more dire situations. But just want you all to rest assured that the county itself is moving on what we have been appropriated.
Great.
And that is some of the discussion, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, that we had at the last NMAC board meeting just last month, was that some of us counties have local entities, other boards, or, you know, for example, I want to use him as an example, but Mr. Cordova will come in and he'll do his own lobbying efforts, and they'll get funding for certain things, but they don't have an actual agreement with the county to have to provide a fiscal agent. And so that kind of puts a cloud on all the things that the county is doing, because there isn't that communication that happens. And once those monies are awarded by the legislature, then everyone's kind of wondering as to what is going on, and the county kind of gets blamed, like we did, you know, when that last list was made available. And so if you can develop your own method as well, or inform all of these other local entities as to what those deadlines are and what the process is, then I think we could be able to establish a better vehicle for communication amongst everybody. And we don't have to be on this list of a report card that was issued out just recently.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioner, I agree. Thank you. And I think that is important for the county to be able to take that role on. And being blamed for not moving the money out fast enough is one aspect of it, but the other side is to see any money that was given to Taos County in general reverted. I don't want to see that. And I don't think any of us do either. And if we can do our part to help these entities keep the money in the county, spend it, and get the projects completed, it makes everyone look good, including our representative and senator, who would love to be able to go to bat for us, but they need to know that we are capable of moving that money quickly and getting it out the door.
And along that, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, is that we also need to develop a plan for the excess monies that we have as to where those are going to go, because our senators and representatives are already questioning excess funds, and in their minds, I'm sure they're thinking, well, does the county really need to borrow or get money from the legislature if they already have this big pot of money?
Mr. Chairman, we do have big reserves, but it's only been this year that we have a balanced budget. And you know, I think that the understanding of that on their level would help go a long way, and I'll do my part to make sure that they understand we are now ready to have surplus money on a year-to-year basis, hopefully in perpetuity. I hope we never have a budget shortfall again that we can't conquer. But yes, we need to have that plan, and we will. We'll make sure that they understand that we are committed to the projects as much as they are.
Well, Mr. Chairman, it's just like if, say, we were, for example, to go ask for money for Camino Medio. It included in the letter, if we were to make a decision, we would say we have pledged X amount out of our surplus, and that we want additional. Anyway, I mean, I think there's ways we can address that.
A veteran cemetery is a big for me as well, Mr. Chairman, the old courthouse.
So,
I just have a comment on the old courthouse. I was criticized last week by people saying that we're not doing anything there. I don't think they really see the behind the scenes that it's taking to get to that point, but it was pretty sharp criticism.
And Commissioner Fowler did mention learning about more access to funds, and we will pursue that for our historic county courthouse. I think it goes a long way that we've already secured $500,000 on our own through our borrowing and refinancing, so that goes a long way in improving our commitment. We also have the opportunity to sit through a lot of New Mexico True, the campaign, and some of their really cool commercials, and I think it's something that we certainly have to do for our county.
Yeah.
I do feel that there are parts of our county that have been underrepresented thus far, and luckily New Mexico True can't be a campaign without Taos County. I just couldn't imagine them not being able to showcase the town, the Ski Valley, Red River, the Gorge, but they're neglected to showcase maybe Sipapu and our beautiful southern part of RCCLA up in Amalia, Ojo Caliente, and even our Earthships on the west side. So in our pursuit of it, I think that's the way I think the county would like to move forward, is the rest of it. You know, we're pretty well represented in the town and the Ski Valley, and we need to showcase what everyone else is missing. And so I think that's the pursuit we're gonna go for. We are trying to schedule a meeting with the tourism department to get all that started and kick that off. I've had the chance to talk to our clerk and deputy clerk about lodgers' tax and how we may be able to use the lodgers' tax and maybe even partner with Riverview and Santa Fe County on a project like Highroad to Taos as an example, because it does cross three counties, and the more money we could cobble together, then New Mexico True matches that, or maybe even more, for a really great campaign that can add tax dollars to an underserved part of the county.
It truly becomes New Mexico True at that point.
Yes.
Yes. Because they're showing the stuff that they're showing, you know, the last presentation before the NMAC board, again, a few weeks ago in Socorro, they showed all these wonderful places, but they failed to show Taos Pueblo, St. Francis Church, the Gorge Bridge, Taos Key Valley, all these wonderful things that we have. Yeah. Those are the primary reasons why people come to New Mexico.
It's a gorgeous state, end to end, corner to corner. We just have, in my opinion, have a beautiful, the most beautiful part of it. So. It's hard to showcase every part of Taos County when it's all gorgeous.
Andrew, can you go over the steps we're going to be taking to spend that that money that we secured with the lodgers tax loan on Ag Center and Old County Courthouse?
Based on the anti-donation issues we have, we're really first looking at leases and the future lease of how that will look when we go forward, because as you know, we can't draw down any of that money until we are in compliance with anti-donation. So right now, that's step one. Is getting a good lease that we are all comfortable with, and then we're going to move forward. I think we haven't decided we need an RFP. If we do offer in-kind, we will have to do an RFP in order for that in-kind to be able to be considered and do a payment. We do need to do a full appraisal of the building, so we're moving forward with that also. We're going to try and do a pre-appraisal, and then one after we put some money into it. But we are moving in that direction. We did agree to allow the current tenants to stay through the winter months definitely, and then depending on what our final plan is, we will have to decide what we're going to do with them. There may be opportunity to move them around and allow them to stay, but it looks like it would be easier to get a lot more done if we just emptied it out and got things done.
We can't draw down any money unless it's either emptied out or we have leases that have been approved by DFA.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
And it's going to take some time to get leases approved by DFA. I mean, especially since we don't have any tenants identified, but
typically. We are also moving on the parallel path of looking for design and architecture work. So we can do the RFP for design and architecture, line everything up as long as we're moving on parallel paths. So that when we do, are ready to make a payment, we are able to easily draw down that money.
Thank you.
Could I just ask, where do you start? Because it would seem like doing the leases at the Ag Center would be like first step, easiest. Most of them aren't probably going to have in-kind services. I don't know, but it seemed like that would be like the place to get the educational background of moving these forward, and then moving over to the courthouse. I still love the opinion of working out leases that people can do trades. And as Commissioner Gallegos had said, some way keeping the building open. My understanding was we were going to do the roof first and the elevator and the bathrooms. So is that what you're referring to for the design of how we're going to renovate the roof and the elevators and the, where the bathrooms are going to go? Is that the first?
Yes.
Okay.
That's the very first. And, you know, in regards to the in-kind and the ability to offer that, I do caution, I mean, it's, if when we do determine fair market value, it'll be very difficult to be able to give in-kind to too many people and still meet the requirements. So, you know, the in-kind, I just, well, I mentioned it before, I'll mention it again, it's going to be very difficult for an entity to meet the in-kind requirements. We are going to certainly have to have some cash revenue coming into that building to meet fair market value. And that's just the reality of it.
Well, when you say that, my concern is Taos County Historical Society's gone. They have no money. But they do curate shows there, you know. So I'm just a little concerned that we're going to see Taos County Historical Society gone, Taos Arts Council, 10, I don't know, 10, they do a lot of their, they're not even in there, but they,
Anyway, so I do want to see some of these leases for trade. I know how difficult it may be, but when you say that, to me, that sounds like, and Taos County Historical Society is very concerned, you know, about being kicked out, so.
Be a lot easier upstairs and downstairs, because upstairs is worth less, so the first step really is to get an appraiser to tell us what these things are worth, what these places are worth, and then we can start negotiating.
Is that the same for the ag center? And I'm sorry, I keep seeing Bob has his hand up, Mr. Chairman.
Well, I communicate with you through Commissioner Rebell.
It's a good thing about being in the seat, I mean,
For clarification purposes, we can't just, if there's going to be in-kind, and clearly we all understand that we want in-kind available for some of these organizations, if there's going to be in-kind, we can't just negotiate it directly, it has to comply with procurement. DFA's opinion of 2007 specifically says that, so that's where the RFP comes in.
That's where the RFP comes in, and then you do have to match up the value to the service. It's a whole lot easier on community centers than it is at the Old County Courthouse, because that building is worth more. If you've got a tenant who's paying fair market value, you don't have to go out for an RFP, you can just sign them up, but you still have to get approval from DFA. It's a long, difficult process, and if we want to draw down any of that money in our lifetimes, we're going to have to probably clear the slate first and then work on that concurrent path to negotiate. But the first step is to get that value. We can't negotiate unless we know what it's worth.
Who's not paying the Ag Center? You know?
No, I don't know specifically from the last walkthrough I had at the Ag Center. It sounded like the one that we had a big question on was paying a sublease, that they were paying a lease to someone else. We do got to look a little deeper into whether that was.
There's two possibilities that I can think of. One is 4-H. I don't think that there's any lease that they're paying under. And the sublease that Andrew was talking about, I think, is the Cattlemen's Association.
Mm-hmm. And the Taos Valley Seki Association, are they subleasing under soil and water?
I don't know the answer to that.
I believe so. That's what it's, that's what I took away from my last visit over there.
And that's legal?
We haven't had the opportunity to verify that. I don't think it's illegal. It's certainly not anything, but we do have to reread the lease, and I think what the only question may be is whether they're receiving the fair market value as necessary, as required.
And if it's government to government, like soil and water, and the agricultural extension agent, can we just let them have that for free, or does it still have to be a fair market value if it's government to government?
Government to government does not require fair market value. It still requires approval by DFA.
So, if there's no more questions on that, this will be an item, obviously, I'll keep bringing back to you. So you're going to hear more updates on the Ag Center and the Historic County Courthouse as we keep moving along. The next point, I just want to, just for informational purposes, our audit is complete. We had our audit exit interview on Friday afternoon. We got it into the state auditor by the deadline yesterday, and that's one less thing for us to lose sleep over. It was a little bit more challenging this year because the state auditor moved our deadline up from November 15th to November 1st. So we were able to get it in under the wire and we were complete. Commissioner Calder was in attendance for the commissioners, and I can't give you details about it until it's been released by the state auditor, which I hope we can kind of fast track and get it out there. But at that time, sometime hopefully either late year or early new year, our auditor will come and give you a full report on the results.
Right. Did I get any awards at the NMAC?
I am certainly going to lobby.
I'd be looking for it.
Yes.
But we're sworn to no statements, but I'm leaning that way.
We're not perfect, unfortunately. I wish I could say we were perfect, but we're not bad. We have accomplished a lot in the last few years through the audit, removing a lot of findings. And so that being said, I'll give you the results as soon as they're able to be made public.
There's a couple you're probably going to get a chuckle out of.
Get a what?
Good, chuckle. always look forward to that.
I chuckles.
And so the last point I have on my list today is just talking some more about the November 10th special meeting. We do want to schedule that to go over our legislative priorities. At that time, you'll be going to get your road priorities, your full comprehensive road list, as has been requested by school commissioners. And then we also need to pass a loan resolution in relation to the fire excise zone. So that does require a super majority. We hope there's at least four of you here that day to be able to do that. If that's not the case, that will be moved back to another meeting. We'll push back our whole schedule. And then, as directed today, we'll add the hospital onto that work study meeting and have some discussion about that. So.
How long have you been, Mr. Chairman, in the term?
It's 1 month yesterday.
I don't see any white hairs.
I pluck them.
Thank you very much, Andrew.
Thank you.
Doesn't work after a while, you'd be bald.
It's happening fast.
Thanks for that, Andrew. Very informative. Appreciate it very much. On to the last item on our agenda today, which is 15A. This is legal matters, and it's a discussion and possible decision regarding Taos County versus Carmen Rael, and it is a matter that can be discussed in executive session. Commissioners, do we have a motion to go into
executive session? Motion to go into executive session, Mr. Chair.
Vice Chair Bembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blakenham?
Yes. I guess we can stay down here. I don't think it's going to take very long, and we'll come back.
Thank you for the article from Taos News.
Come back and ask for a motion to come back to session.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Vice Chair Fambro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes. Commissioners, we have a motion. Mr. Malone, will you please give us a report on the executive session?
The County Commission met in executive session pursuant to Open Meetings Act Exemption 1015-1H7, which allows for discussion of pending or threatened litigation in connection with Taos County versus Carmen Rael. That was the only matter discussed. No action was taken.
Move to accept the report from our attorney.
Second.
Vice Chair Fambro.
Yes.
Commissioner Romero.
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell.
Yes.
Chairman Blankenhorn.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Commissioner.
Motion to reject the settlement offer presented by counsel.
Second, Mr. Chairman.
And would we like to add instruction to our attorney to pursue another settlement?
Since you have more legal ease than a dumb fire, I would invite you to amend my motion.
Well, that's not as good as I can do.
Okay.
We have an amended motion and we have a friendly second to that amendment.
Vice Chair Fembo?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blakenhorn?
Yes. Is there anything else,
Chairman, before you adjourn, just a quick reminder that there's three large zoning maps that are part of the LUR that was passed today that need to be signed by the Commissioner of the LUR.
Okay. No further business?
Motion to adjourn, Solera Park will go eat.
Vice Chair Fembro?
Yes.
Commissioner Romero?
Yes.
Commissioner O'Donnell?
Yes.
Chairman Blakenhorn?
Yes.
Thanks for taking care of me.
Thank you. Where are you eating?
I should have.
I don't know.